Bottom of the first inning, first wraps up coming for Jacksonville against the Florida Gators here tonight. And their starter, Timmy Manning, a left-hander. So a Jacksonville lineup that you talked about earlier, Chris Lehane, featuring some defense, but also featuring a lot of right-handers in it as well to counteract the southpaw on the mound as Manning makes his third start of the year. He has pitched 10 innings so far this season, allowing 5 runs on 7 hits. He has struck out 8. He has also walked 8. Opponents not hitting a ton off of him, just 194, but he has shown probably some of the control stuff that you would expect from a young guy. And we get a lefty-on-lefty matchup to start things with Ruben Simeon, who's actually a reverse splits guy, as he takes a first-pitch fastball in the outer half for a strike. Simeon against lefties this year hits .333. He's batting .230 against righties. The 1-0. Slices one foul to the left side and out of play. Ball and a strike. I believe I said that first one was a called strike. I really have already decided I hate Randy Olhausen's strike call because I can't see it.
He's got what they call the knock on the door. Yeah. That's what he calls it.
Yeah, it's not enough. I need a little bit. I like the turn and the point. I can't miss that. Slicing the other way and into left field, Ruben Simeon with a leadoff single. He continues to blister the baseball in leadoff scenarios. As a leadoff guy, came into tonight hitting 417, 20 for 48 when he leads off an inning. That's why he is so good at what he does in this position in the lineup.
Ruben's swing has not changed since the moment he got on campus. He knows who he is as a hitter. He's got a great approach at the plate. And honestly, the only thing Ruben battles with at the plate is his own head. And I think he's got that point at that point in his career where he knows what he is, he knows what he needs to do, and he's just going to be Mr. Consistent all the time.
Here's a guy on the other end of his career in Jesus Pacheco, who takes a first-pitch fastball at the knees for a strike. Runner on first. Nobody out in a scoreless game in the bottom of the first between Jacksonville and Florida. Pacheco has really impressed early in his career, as he has started all but one game at second base here this season. A big breaking ball that is in at the knees for strike two, and Pacheco quickly down in the count. The freshman, 29th start of the season, hitting .272. He's third on the team in batting average amongst those that qualify, have played 75% of the Dolphins games. And he is really, he's gotten better as the season gone on, and that's what you want to see from a young guy. 0-2 pitch. Breaking ball, and he is fooled. Swings and misses and strikes out. Manning makes short work of his freshman counterpart for out number one here in the bottom of the first.
Yeah, just, you know, he's trying to protect there. Gets a curveball up in the zone. It's one of those weird pitches, especially when you're in defense mode. It's tough to hit a curveball at the top of the zone. I mean, it starts at your neck, at your head area, and then drops down to the top of the strike zone. It's one of those weird pitches that, now, if you make contact, it's weird. It'll go, but it's tough to get to.
I'll throw over to first to check on Samayan. Back in standing up. Ruben actually has the dubious honor of being one of the tops in the A-Sun and having been caught stealing this year 4 times. 2 for 6 so far this season. Did swipe a bag the other day for the first time in a while. A week ago today, in fact. There's a breaking ball into Dakota Jalila to start things off. He takes something you don't see Dakota do a whole lot, and it's a called strike. And we have seen Manning here early, but he has leaned on that big bending breaking ball here so far to these Jacksonville hitters who have a tendency to be aggressive at the top of the order. The 0-1. Down in the dirt again on another breaking ball. This one blocked as it slid away from Greenfield behind the plate. He was able to track it down to keep Simeon from advancing. A ball and a strike to count on Jalila, who has settled into this spot in the 3-hole for much of the second half of the year after the injury to Tommy Joseph at Florida. Back a little over a month ago, really shook up how this lineup looked at the top. Throw over to first. Look out. That one nearly thrown away. Great job by Hickey. Boy, I think I just pulled an oblique looking at him reach across the back of Samayan in order to keep that one from flying all the way into the corner. And Hickey, a catcher by trade, too, making a nice play over there. 1-1 pitch. Fastball grounded hard through the hole. It's short, and it skitters into left field for a one-out single for Dakota Jalila. And Jacksonville has something going here with one out in the first.
Yeah, early on, you can kind of tell Manning is trying to get a feel for his pitches, and it doesn't look like he has anything that's going to beat you, anything you got to be afraid of. I would expect or hope that, you know, the Dolphin hitters will be a little bit patient, especially that first time up. Let him show you what he has, and know going in he's not going to beat you with that fastball. He doesn't have a lights-out fastball that's, you know, it's going to, you know, light up the radar gun. Let him come to you. You know, let him show him your stuff. And I think if the Dolphin hitters are patient, don't be over-aggressive, and they're going to hit Manning around.
Freshman-on-freshman matchup for Jackson Grabski against Timmy Manning, and he takes the curveball on the inner half for a called strike. Manning from Pompano Beach, Florida, Cardinal Gibbons product. 6'2", left-hander, facing off against Jackson Grabski, who has been, if nothing else, I would say Jacksonville's most consistent player this year. I mean, he really hasn't had the highs or the lows. He has just been kind of right there all season long and has been impressive in his temperament as a true freshman starting at the hot corner.
And that, like you said, it's impressive to see a freshman show that type of consistency. You see a lot of highs and lows, a lot of peaks and valleys with freshmen getting a lot of playing time, and that's something you expect. It's not, you know, necessarily a negative thing, but, you know, this guy showing that he can do it day in and day out, it's exciting for the future.
0-1 pitch, and that hit Grabski in the left leg.
It also bounced on the grass in front of home plate.
Yeah, that was about a 58-footer or so, maybe, 57-footer, and ends up catching Grabski in the left leg. That's an easier way to wear one than most of the time.
Yeah, see it coming,
take a little of the heat off of it, too.
Manning just tried to get a, you know, he pulled a curveball. He spiked it into the ground. He reached out a little too far, and, you know, you see that with the left-handed batter trying to go back foot slider or curveball and just spiked it.
Second time he's been hit this year. And Duncan Hunter delivers with a base hit down the line on the first pitch he sees, scoring Samayan, rounding third and coming home to score Jalila. Here comes Grabski being waved around, and he scores. And a 3 RBI bases clearing double for Duncan Hunter, who has now driven in runs in 4 straight games.
What a huge swing early on in this game. Putting a 3-spot up in the first inning. You know, when you're facing a potent offense like the Florida Gators, it is important to score early and often. You do not want to chase from behind against these guys, and that's a huge swing there from Duncan Hunter. You know, you got bases loaded. They got nowhere to put you. He's got to go right after you. And, you know, only one out, you know, the pressure's kind of off. You just got to hit a ball hard and hope it finds a hole, and that's what he did. So great job by Duncan Hunter there, and Dolphins take a 3-0 lead.
Brings up Trace Burchard with the runner at second and one out. Jacksonville leading 3-0. A swing and a miss on a breaking ball down and in. It rolls up the line a little bit from Greenfield, but Hunter stays put. Seemed that Young had a hard time digging that ball out in the corner. It ended up rolling down the line and deep into the left corner where there was not much speed in that ball coming back in. I mean, Grabski wasn't exactly flying, and he was able to score standing up at the plate without a throw. And with one out, too, the 0-1. Burchard takes a fastball at the knees for strike two.
Yeah, the warning track here is a little bit different than in a lot of places. It's got that thick crushed brick with a softer dirt underneath it. When you go to places, especially, a little bit of the nicer ballparks, you know what I mean by, like, the Florida States Floridas.
Call those high major ballparks.
Yeah.
0-2 pitch swung on and missed. It rolls away from Greenfield up the first base line. He picks it up with the bare hand and tosses down to first. Hunter advances to third on that strikeout and wild pitch. And Jacksonville has a man down at third base with two outs.
Yeah, when you go to those ballparks, and a ballpark that, you know, the Gators play in, the track's a little firmer, not as much crush brick. Actually, it kind of feels like an infield. along the lines. But here it's a lot softer. And, you know, if you're not used to it, you're going to get trapped by it because especially when you're running full speed and trying to come to a stop and pick up that ball, your cleat will dig into that crushed brick and kind of sink. And you really got to press down in that baseball. You're gonna lose your footing. And that's probably why there wasn't a lot of speed behind that throw. He couldn't really get much power off his back foot.
Runner at third, two outs. First pitch to Corey Heffron is a called strike. Fastball outer half to the right-handed swinging left fielder here tonight. Heffron has been the main catcher for Jacksonville this season in his third year with the Dolphins, but has moved back to play the outfield here tonight where he spent much of his first two seasons, the 0-1 pitch, and he is tied in knots on another nice breaking ball from Manning, and it's quickly 0-2 on the Jacksonville redshirt senior.
Yeah, this is what I'm talking about with being a little too over-aggressive. You saw it with Trace last at-bat, now Hef. Just getting a little too aggressive on those curveballs early. You know, you got to be able to see it. Don't get too out in front. Just let him come to you and let him bring that fastball.
0-2 pitch, another breaking ball. This time Heffron had a good eye on it as it bounces in the dirt, kicks back onto the field, and Greenfield runs it down again. He's been active here behind the dish in this first inning, but when you have a guy who's relying a lot on a big, heavy breaking ball, you imagine that would be part of the case.
Especially when he's put a couple about 4 or 5 feet short of the plate right now. We saw the one get away, but there's also been a couple that have been really close.
1-2 pitch, another curve ball, and this one called strike three. That ball nearly hit Heffron in the hands and ruled to have been a strike by Randy Olhausen. All right, we head to the second. Jacksonville off to a nice start thanks to the 3 RBI bases clearing double by Duncan Hunter to get the Dolphins started offensively here tonight. Mike Casala back to the mound with a lead, 3-0 through one here in Jacksonville. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Dolphin Athletics gear and swag. Visit jugear.com to stock up on all things Nike today. Nike BSN, the official apparel of Jacksonville Athletics.
Back in Jacksonville, Scott Manzi and Chris Lahane with you as we head to the second inning on a beautiful night for baseball here on the First Coast. An in-state rivalry renewed, the 98th all-time meeting between Jacksonville and Florida, and Jacksonville has a 3-0 lead early on the strength of a bases-clearing 3-RBI double by Duncan Hunter. Here's Mike Casala back to the mound working with a lead as he faces Judd Fabian, who was at the plate when Kirby McMullen was caught trying to take second base on a wild pitch. And he starts him off with a fastball on the outer edge for a strike. This should play right into the hands of Casala, who, as you documented in the first inning, likes to fill the zone. 0-1. Hit hard down to third off of the glove of Grabski and into left field. And Fabian, who just put enough MPH behind that one, where it took a big hop on Grabski, who got the glove up but just a half second too late. And it goes right off the top of it and into left for a leadoff single for Judd Fabian.
That's a tough play. It's one that you want to have as a pitcher after a three-run inning from your offense. You're coming out looking to get a shutdown inning. There's nothing better than a three-up, three-down after putting up a crooked number. But, you know, that's a hot play right there. And, you know, for Grabski, a tough one, but you want to have it.
Sterling Thompson, first pitch swinging, drives one deep into right center field. Hunter going back to the wall, looking up, and it's gone. Sterling Thompson with a two-run home run. And at two swings of the bat, Florida's back within 1-3-2.
And that's what they'll do. That's what the Florida Gators will do. They can swing it. They're going to put the ball, over the yard. We saw it when we went down there in the three-game series. They put on a display those, that especially that second game. But, it's one of those things where, they're going to get their pitches and they're not going to miss them. And, as a starting pitcher or any pitcher for that matter, you really got to try to hit your spots and keep it away from the middle of the zone or guys like these are going to make them pay.
So Thompson hits his third home run of the season as the first pitch into Josh Rivera. Is ball one high. Rivera had a great series against Jacksonville the first time. Thompson only played in one game against the Dolphins in that series down in Gainesville last month. The 1-0 pitch is knocked down the line in right, a foul ball to even the count at one apiece. He started in right on Friday night, went 1-for-2 with an RBI and a couple of runs scored. Also drew a walk, hit a triple in that game, and we did not see him the rest of the series. But he made the most of his opportunity here tonight in his first at-bat, leaving the yard for the third time this season. The 1-1 pitch. Right-hander swings and slaps one down toward third, charging in on it. Grabski backhands even with the bag at third base, fires across the diamond to Richardson in time, and Rivera's out for out number one.
For the Gators, now batting the third baseman.
It's a big out. Hey, I know it's only one on, one in the scorebook, but just take a deep breath as a pitcher. You gave up a two-run bomb, but you're still up one, and, there's still 8.5 innings to play. And just being able to, get the next guy is huge. And this next guy is not an easy out, Jacksonville local Colby Holter.
Yes, it is. He is hitting 319 this season in his 34th start of the year. The left-handed swinging freshman from Bishop Kenny High School just down the river takes just inside with a slider to start for ball one. Holter starting at third tonight. He played second the entirety of the series against Jacksonville back in March. He's got family and friends in attendance down to our right here tonight who certainly made themselves heard when he was introduced. The 1-0. Off the end of the bat, slowly hit to the left side. Grabski can't field it, but Jalila's there to back it up. Throws across to first and just does beat Halter, speeding down the line. And even had a moment to double pat before he fired that baseball, showing off the arm strength. Dakota Jalila for a big out number two.
That's a heck of a play right there. I don't know if it caught Grabski's glove. It looked like Coda kind of had to take a hitch to the left after Grabski went for it with his glove. But stay collected, field it, and know how much time he had. It's a really good play by Dakota. And like you said, his arm strength is pretty impressive.
Here's Corey Acton. And the first pitch to the left-handed swinging second baseman misses down and in. A fastball that bounces away. I'm with you. I think that ball hit the glove of Grabski, and not by much.
Yeah.
I mean, it didn't redirect it by a ton and worked out for Jacksonville in that regard. But, man, just showing how comfortable Dakota is when he is uncomfortable at the shortstop position. The 1-0 is a fastball upstairs.
Yeah, and listen, Dakota hasn't had the perfect season at shortstop that, at least we're expected from him. I mean,
yeah.
He's
and maybe he's, unreasonable to expect
yeah.
what we expect from him.
And he's just so good with the glove, and it's so impressive what he can do. I expect nothing less.
2-0 pitch, check swing on a fastball in the inner half called. Oh, no, they appeal down to third, and Arthur Thigpen said yes, he did go around on the check swing. So Acton takes strike one there. It's now 2-1. Acton has not had the season that Gator fans are used to him having. I mean, he's been a regular in the lineup for his previous two seasons as he takes a fastball a little low to make it 3-1. This is only the sixth game he has started this year, and part of it is I think he's just an odd man out with how deep this infield is for Florida this year and the fact that he's also hitting just 3-for-21 on the season. 3-1 pitch. Slider at the letters called ball four. And Mike Casale is saying, what about that one when that curveball got called strike three on my guy last inning? But Acton does a nice job to draw the walk there. That is the ninth time he has drawn a walk. So for a guy whose batting average is sitting just down at 143, he came in with an on-base percentage of 400, and that has just ticked up and gives the Gators a two-out base runner. And this is where you really want to make sure that that two-out walk doesn't burn you, and that has been something that has unfortunately gone against Jacksonville a lot of times here this season. Nine-hole hitter Cal Greenfield, and he takes a first pitch strike on the low outside corner to the right-handed swinging backstop. First walk issued tonight by Mike Casala, and the 14th man he has walked this season, takes his lead Acton at first base with two outs, the 0-1 pitch. And that is a breaking ball that misses a little up and in to even the count. 3-2, Jacksonville leads it in the top of the second inning. Gators have responded with a two-run home run by Sterling Thompson to start off this inning to get back within one after the Dolphins took an early 3-0 lead. Acton is 1-for-1 of stolen bases this year. Healthy lead over at first. 1-1 pitch. Fastball down and outside. And what you really don't want to do is put another guy on and have that order turnover for you here when you're that close to getting out. And perhaps that's what pitching coach Jerry Edwards has seen. And he wants to go have a word with Mike Casala.
Yeah, that third out is, you know, no matter what inning it is, it's always a weird out to try to get. It, you know, you see, it's like that weird cliche in baseball. You say, oh, those, you know, two out hits win ball games, and you see these big innings happen, and, you know, you see yourself repeating year after year, no matter what game you're watching. You know, you'll hear, you know, a big two out inning, you know, all this done with two outs. And it's just, it's one of those weird things in baseball that guys just kind of think they simplify when, you know, especially with runners on base with two outs, you get that first hit with two outs, you know, whether it's the third guy that comes to the plate, he gets that knock. The guys behind him get him a little bit more relaxed. You know, they have nothing to lose.
Yeah.
If you hit a hard line drive center field, he's out. So what? You go to defense, you know, whatever. You have a little more pressure when you're leading off the inning and you know, you're trying to get on base for your team, but when there's two outs, you know, a little less pressure on you. You're just trying to, you know, do your job.
After the mound visit, the next pitch is a swing and a miss on a slider to Greenfield, and that evens the count at 2-2. Hopefully, Jerry just said, go throw that. And that may have been the amount of the visit. I know that Coach Edwards has really tried to just hone in on the right way to handle different guys on this coaching staff. Second year with the team. A lot of new faces on this pitching staff this year. 2-2 pitch, hit on the ground to the right side, and Pacheco sliding stop in shallow right field, but he's unable to come up with it cleanly as his glove came off as he went sliding to his left. He was able to stop the baseball from advancing, but no chance to make a play at first, and what amounts to an infield single for Cal Greenfield, and the Gators have first and second with two outs in the top of the order coming up. I tell you what, Pacheco, I mean, that's a play that goes down to the book because it's nothing more than an infield single. And it doesn't probably – he kept the guy going first to third on just range.
Yeah, they say diving bodies with two outs. Just do anything you can to knock it down and keep the, you know, guys from moving to the next base.
First pitch swinging and a breaking ball swung on and missed by Young, and he falls behind 0-1. He is the lone strikeout victim of Mike Casala so far this evening.
And this is where you definitely want to say diving bodies in the infield because, you know, if you make a stop with the glove, you might not get the out, but you might save a run.
He takes a pitch outside now. Young does to make it 1-1. 36 pitches now on the night for Mike Casala. A good percentage of them coming here this inning, especially the last couple of hitters. A lot of the guys early in the inning were aggressive. Judd Fabian swinging on the second pitch, Thompson on the first. 1-1 pitch, and that is belted back up the middle. Samayan on the run to his left, and he makes the catch over the shoulder to end the inning and strand a couple of Gators on the base paths. It is still a Jacksonville advantage. 3-2, though, a little bit closer. Sterling Thompson's two-run home run brings the Gators within one. We head to the bottom of the second. Jacksonville's Stephen Moffitt leads it off when we return from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Jacksonville 3, Florida 2. Shinatry Chiropractic is a proud sponsor of JU Athletics. Located east of downtown in the Arlington neighborhood, Shinatry Chiropractic specializes in acupuncture for pain relief and sports performance. For more information about Shinatry Chiropractic, please visit www.shinatrydc.com.
Yeah. Not right upon. Three to two, Jacksonville leads it as we head to the bottom of the second inning. John Sessions Stadium. Sun continuing to set. Everybody is in the shadows now in the field. Just a little bit of sunshine right there at the 405 mark in center left on this beautiful night for baseball. Temperatures high 70s here today on the first coast. Light breeze. Jacksonville bringing 8-9-1 to the plate here this inning. Scott Manzi with Chris Lehane. As Jacksonville tries to keep the Gators at bay, add to the lead here at home. First pitch is up and in on Moffitt, tonight's designated hitter, making his fifth start of the season, all of them at the DH spot. Manning out for a second inning of work on the mound. The lefty kicks and fires the 1-0, check swing, and Moffitt went around on a pitch in the inner half, now 1-1. Jacksonville playing its first game in a week. Last played at the Citadel last Tuesday and dropped a heartbreaker in 11 innings. The 1-1 pitch, big curveball, and called strike two. If that is going to be called a strike, Jacksonville hitters don't stand a chance tonight because that's not a hittable pitch, and it is way in on guys' hands. Another breaking ball lifted high in the air into right center field. This could be trouble. Bermuda Triangle, and it's the right fielder charging in, Thompson, who calls everybody off and makes the catch for out number one. One out with Kyle Richardson coming to the plate.
Number 21, Kyle Richardson.
Kyle Richardson hit his first career home run 2 weekends ago at FGCU, a two-run shot down in Fort Myers. He and Tyler McKenna both hit their first career home runs down there in that last weekend series that Jacksonville played, as the first pitch is a fastball that misses up and in for ball one to the right-handed swinging first baseman.
Just a guy you like to root for in Kyle Richardson.
Swing and a miss to even the count at 1-1. Yeah, nice kid, great family. Local product from Fernandina Beach, just up the road.
He's got all the tools, and you know, you can see it every now and then, and you know, hopefully he just finds it.
1-1 pitch down and in, and it is skied into foul territory left side and beyond the seats. Ball and two strikes to Richardson. Top of the order awaiting on deck. One out, bases empty. 3-2 Jacksonville, bottom of the second. One-two pitch coming from Manning. Another breaking ball and a swing and a miss, and Richardson down on strikes, and Manning has sat down the first two he has faced here in this inning, and he has struck out four now in the ballgame, including three of his last four that he has faced, and here comes Ruben Simayan, who is one of those three hits off of him here tonight. He got everything started in the first with a single the other way, something that he has made a trademark in his Jacksonville career. First pitch is a breaking ball in the inner half, called a strike. And Manning is starting to have a little more success in consistently locating that curveball. And he is pitching backward throughout the course of this game, setting up the fastball. Buried one down in the dirt there. And it's a ball and a strike.
I don't want to say he's pitching backwards because I don't know the numbers, but you're seeing as many breaking balls as you are fastballs, and that's what I meant earlier by being patient and let him come to the fastball to you.
Goes back to the breaking ball, locates on the outer half, and it is strike two called. Ball and two strikes to Ruben Simayan with two outs of the bases empty here in the second. Manning trying to sit down the Dolphins in order after a little bit of a stressful first inning. There's another breaking ball that misses upstairs that time, and it is 2-2 to Ruben. Simayan, who is continuing to climb the all-time charts with his start here tonight. He has now passed head coach Chris Hayes for sixth most all-time games played in Jacksonville history. Swing and a miss, and it has been a steady diet of big breakers from Timmy Manning, and he has struck out five, including two this inning, as he sits down the Dolphins in order in the second. We head to the third, 3-2, Jacksonville on top from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Score after two innings of play, Jacksonville 3, Florida 2. Attention parents, is your child interested in playing baseball? Sign up for our JU Baseball Youth Summer Camps, where your child will receive instruction from our very own coaches and players. More information can be found on collegebaseballcamps.com/JU. Look forward to seeing you this summer.
Two down, 3-2, Jacksonville leads it as we work on here on this Tuesday night at John Sessions Stadium. 2-3 and 4 due up for the Gators here this inning with Nathan Hickey leading it off. Mike Casala back out for another inning of work, 37 pitches thrown for the Dolphins starter here tonight. As he works through the order for the second time here this evening, he retired Hickey on a ground out his first time to the plate. And the lefty from right here in Jacksonville digs in. Hickey's just a nice player, really nice player. First pitch swinging ground ball, but right at the first baseman Richardson, and again, a 3-1 putout for Nathan Hickey, and whatever Mike Casala has dialed up for him has worked to the tune of 2-3-1s to start things off. One out.
That's Mike Casala's favorite, second favorite play on the field is, you know, that's why you see he takes pride in it. He takes pride in fielding his position as a pitcher, but it's also almost like a bit of a joke for him because he loves sprinting over there. But his favorite play is the is right back, the 1-3.
Where
he catches it and sprints runs the read option with the base runner.
First pitch to Kirby McMullen, misses down and outside, a fastball for ball one.
Yeah, if you're ever at a JU baseball game and Mike Casala's pitching, he gets one back to the pitcher, watch him, you know, ball security, has the ball in the glove, two hands, looks at his option man, and then feeds it to the first baseman.
1-0 pitch, fastball a little up and in, two balls, no strikes. I mean, he's an athlete, and he'll tell you that. Of course, started his career catching a lot and was the everyday catcher his sophomore season after kind of serving as the Sunday guy and the closer his first year here on campus. Due to an injury, he was sort of pressed into everyday catching duties, but did a great job. All-tournament team for Jacksonville in the A-Sun tournament in 2017. 2-0 pitch, and McMullen tried to check his swing on an upstairs fastball, went around 2-1. Then he moved more into regular starting role as a junior, got hurt, missed all of the rest of that season and the following season, came back last year as a starter, season gets cut short, and this year he's doing a little bit of both again. 2-1. Fastball, tried to paint the outside corner, doesn't get the call. 3 balls and a strike to McMullen. Base is empty, one out, 3-2. Jacksonville leads, top of the third. Mike Casala trying not to lose Kirby McMullen here. He has walked one so far tonight and has struck out one. The 3-1 pitch. And it is a little outside with another fastball, and he walks McMullen.
For the Gators.
So a runner on for Florida here in the third. And now Casala shifts back to the stretch. And a couple of guys starting to throw down to the Jacksonville bullpen and left. Expected this game to be a little more of a committee-type outing. Judd Fabian.
As a lot of midweeks are.
Yes. Judd Fabian stands in, takes low for ball one. He singled and then came home to score on the two-run home run by Sterling Thompson last inning. And Casale's now approaching 50 pitches. Remember, this is his first start in quite some time. His last start was the 20th of March, a deep drive to center field. Fabian going back on it, Samayan going back on the fly ball by Fabian, and he's able to settle down in front of the warning track to make the catch for out number two. And I'm going to take a deep breath and take a sip of water. Chris, you take things over here.
Yeah, I mean, that was a really good swing, but great read by Ruben. I mean, I think we don't have to say it with Ruben and reading his fly balls. I mean, his first step is the most important with him. And, you know, Ruben, he's fast, but he's not going to beat a lot. I mean, he is going to beat a lot of people in a race, but he's not that, you know, lightning fast center fielder that you think of with him as the first, what is that, bull? I'm not a play-by-play guy,
yeah,
Francie.
Pitch misses. I'm back.
but he can read a fly ball, man. His first step is so impressive. His routes to the ball are so good. And Ruben, I mean, if the ball's hit the center field, if he has a chance, he's got it.
Runner at first, two outs, 1-0 count on Sterling Thompson, who homered last time up. A lob over to first. And I like those when the guy dives before he realizes that throw's not coming anywhere near catching him. And
that's the worst.
And you, as a former base runner, position player, would certainly feel that way. 1-0 pitch. Slicing toward left field. This is carrying over the head of Jalila. Falls in front of Heffron for a base hit. And Thompson didn't get that one by much. After the last one he hit, he got all of, but it was enough to find the green grass in between the left fielder and shortstop. And Florida trying to put together a two-out rally to tie things up, trailing 3-2.
That is the same guy. That is the same guy as Coach Hayes would say in the batting cage when we're hitting on the field. Somebody hits a home run over the scoreboard during BP, and the next pitch, you know, pops up to the turtle cage, and same guy, same guy hitting. You know, gets blown up on a fastball for a little single.
First pitch, fastball down and outside to Rivera. Nice job by Burchard sliding to his right to keep that one from getting away. Man in scoring position is Kirby McMullen. Two outs. Mike Casale has thrown 48 pitches here tonight. Rivera 0-for-1 on the night. Runners at first and second. The 1-0. And that misses down and away again. And Casale falling behind hitters a little bit more here than he was early. He has not thrown a first pitch strike yet this inning, unless you count the ground out on the first pitch to Nathan Hickey.
Casale's 2-0. Misses on the outside part of the plate. And Scott, you know, this is a huge batter for Mike here. He's down 3-0. You want to see him try to fight back and make Josh Rivera put something in play. You don't want to load the bases. Now he does have two outs. He's got to get one more, but you got to keep a crooked number off the scoreboard here if you're the Dolphins and Mike Casale. And he gets one in there. That's a good sign there, 3-1 count. But, you know, you're hoping Mike can fight back here and get this third out and avoid a big inning.
Three balls, one strike to count, two outs. Casale trying to battle his way back and get out of this one without allowing a run. Trying to keep that tying run from scoring at second base. 3-1 pitch. And it's a fastball upstairs, and Rivera walks. And that loads the bases with two outs.
For the Gators.
And one of the most dangerous seven-hole hitters in the nation, Colby Holter. I mean, this guy is a very, very talented player. He's a freshman that does not look like a freshman when he's playing. He's going to impress a lot of people, and he's going to be playing professional baseball in a few years. I mean, this guy can swing it, he can field it, and he can really throw it. And I know he's at second base, but, you know, if you knew Colby Holter when he was in high school, he'd be pumping in the mid-90s on the mound. I mean, this kid is a heck of a baseball player.
First pitch from Casale misses down and away to Holter, the left-handed swinging third baseman, who's 0-for-1 tonight with the ground out to short on that excellent play made by Dakota Jalila last inning. Base is loaded and a dangerous spot here. Jacksonville clinging to a 3-2 lead in the top of the third. But Casale just one out away from getting out of it. 1-0 pitch, and it is lined over the head of Grabski at third base into left field. One man comes in to score. The throw is cut off. Two men come in to score, and Florida takes the lead for the first time tonight. 4-3, Gators on top.
Just like I said, you know, Scott, he knows what he needs to do. He knows the job. He knows the assignment, and he's going to do what he has to every single at-bat. He's going to compete. He's one of the toughest outs on the field, no matter what teams are on the field. He's a heck of a baseball player, and he's going to be really, really good for the Gators for a long time.
Here is head coach Chris Hayes coming out of the dugout, and that will do it for Mike Casale. On the mound, 54 pitches for Casale tonight, allows 6 hits, 4 runs, strikes out 1, walks 3, and is responsible for the men at first and second here tonight in this inning as Florida has rallied with 2 runs in each of the last 2 innings to take the lead over Jacksonville here tonight. The signal to the pen has been made. We'll step aside, introduce you to the new Jacksonville arm when we return. 4-3, Florida leads it with 2 outs and runners at first and second in the top of the third from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Dolphins, now pitching, number 34, Tyler Nauman.
If the lights go off, we reset the game at 0, right? Isn't that how it works? Couldn't happen to him.
Hey, you have to show up the next day.
Tyler Nauman takes over on the mound for Mike Casale. He inherits runners at first and second, and a 4-3 ball game in which Florida has the lead over Jacksonville now, thanks to Colby Halter's 2 RBI single a moment ago, which meant the end of the night for Mike Casale. But what did you see from Mike on the mound here tonight, making his first start in about a month?
Yeah, I mean, he was aggressive. He went right after hitters, but you know, his command started to go a little off towards the end of his outing there. You can tell he was probably getting a little tired. His, you know, first time on the mound. He probably used a lot of energy in the first inning, knowing Mike Casale. And
yeah,
you know, and you got to say that Mike Casale's first inning is probably the most important, just on the sense of having a short inning and calming his body down. But you know, you talk about high stress pitches as a pitcher and, you know, putting that on your arm throughout the game and why guys get tired a little bit faster. Well, all of Mike Casale's first innings, no matter how old he's been from freshman until now, are quote unquote high stress pitches just because he gets, you know, his heart pumping so much. And that's just the guy he is.
Yeah.
And that's just the guy he is. And, you know, he lives and dies by it. And he had a longer first inning.
First pitch from Nauman is a fastball call for a strike at the knees to Corey Acton, who stands in with runners at first and second and 2 outs.
But really, it was the second inning. You know, the Gators putting up a 2 spot and throwing a lot of pitches that did Mike Casale in. But, you know, first time out there, it's a midweek. You know, you're hoping you have him for the rest of conference play.
The 0-1 misses low. Nauman has been sort of the de facto midweek starter the last few weeks. He started against Florida State and pitched really well against the Seminoles and kind of helping set the tone for the night in a game that Jacksonville won. Also thanks to the heroics of Christian Coypel at the plate in that game as well.
Yeah, that helped.
The 1-1 pitch. Fastball at the belt for strike 2. But Nauman has, you know, his numbers don't really reflect it, but I think he's pitched a lot better here over the last month than he did probably earlier on in the season. And it's tough. I feel like maybe the least repeatable position as far as success is concerned is relief pitcher for some reason. It just seems to go one year to the next. It's just different. 1-2 pitch, line down the line and left into the terrace. Look out, off of an umbrella down there, a foul ball.
Yeah, that, you know, the relief pitchers, you see guys like, you know, it's hard to say, like, it's like hitting, getting into a hitting rhythm because you're getting 3, 4, 5 at-bats a day, and then you finally, you know, there's times where you don't know if you're going to pitch. I mean, a lot of times you don't know if you're going to pitch. I know midweeks, you know, you kind of know you're going in, you know when you're going in, but throughout the year, it's tough.
1-2 pitch grounded up the middle, and it bounces its way through into center field. Rounding third and coming home, Rivera holding up at third on the play, Halter. An RBI single for Corey Acton of the Seeing Eye variety. And the Gators extend the lead to 2 now, 5-3.
Yeah, that's tough. I mean, Nauman got in on him with the fastball, and he didn't get the barrel to it, but he got enough of that bat on it. Hit it hard enough that, you know, it snuck up the middle. I think the second baseman was shaded a little more towards right field. Cota's playing his normal position. It's one of those ones where you just kind of roll your eyes and say, you know, that's baseball.
I mean, honestly, there's been, out of the hits, there's been some hard hit balls for outs tonight. Out of the hits, the home run is the hardest. That's a hard hit ball. And then a lot of the other ones have been bleeders and balls in the right spot at the right time. Swing and a miss by Cal Greenfield to start the at-bat as Nauman blows a fastball past him. But that's baseball sometimes, right?
That is. I mean, there's nights where you could have, you know, the, like, you call them hard, you know, hard contacts in the book. I mean, one team could lead the hard contact category, you know, by whatever many, but it's about the ones that sneak through. And baseball stinks sometimes, Scott.
Runner at first and third with 2 outs as the 0-1 misses high. Greenfield singled his last time up. That was a ball that was, you know, hit to the right side, and Pacheco gets to it, knocks it down, can't quite make a play on it. And it's just a lot of ground balls here tonight that have led to hits, and a lot of pretty well-stung baseballs into the outfield have been run down. The 1-1. Breaking ball that doesn't really break out of the hand of Nauman. 2 balls and a strike to the 9-hole hitter for the Gators.
It's that same category of the guy who is hot. He's hitting 380, and everything he swings at is falling into the outfield and finding a hole. And then you have the guy hitting, you know, trying to get over 200, and he's lacing balls straight to the center fielder. It's a miserable game, and it doesn't love you back sometimes.
2-1 pitch, fastball misses low. And when Nauman has had some hard times this year, it's been this. You know, he's sort of dancing around the zone, not quite there, falls behind. 3-1 pitch. Tries to catch the outside corner, and Randy Olhausen hasn't given that to anybody tonight. Ball 4. Loads the bases for the second time this inning with a walk. The third man walked this inning, the fourth in this ball game. And unfortunately, that has sort of been the story of the season for Jacksonville. Just a lot, too many free passes at times. And here comes Jacob Young, who's 0-for-2 tonight. Struck out and flown out. But he steps up in a big spot here with Florida leading 5-3. In the top of the third, first pitch swinging and a ground ball. Excellent play. Down at third.
That's a risky one. You miss that. I mean, you know, that's a tougher one. So if you miss it, you don't get too much from the dugout. You know, you're not going to hear it.
Yeah. Third base coach, I should have elaborated, snagging that one. People are probably like, what's Grabski doing? For those that are listening and not watching. The 0-1 buried down inside. Nauman jogging back in case he had to cover the plate. Gators are batted around here now in the third. So the bases are loaded with 2 outs. We played an hour of baseball here just about. 5-2, Florida with a 3-spot after a 2-spot an inning ago, and Nauman locates a fastball at the knees for strike 2. Now 1-2. Dolphins have been 1 out away here. Feels like this entire inning, and it has been almost this whole inning. Breaking ball down in the dirt. Inside on the right hand is swinging Young, 2-2. Young with a chance to really change the tenor of this game if he can find a base hit here. Nauman in his first inning of work trying to get that elusive final out. The 2-2. Big breaking ball, and he struck out Young looking and strands the bases loaded. Jacksonville really needed that to keep it a two-run game. But the Gators with a three spot take the lead, have a 5-3 advantage as we head to the bottom of the third. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
The score after 2.5 innings of play, 4-5, Jacksonville 3. Fans, your Jacksonville Dolphins return home Friday, May 7th, for an A-Sun weekend series with the Florida Gulf Coast Eagles. First pitch is set for 7 o'clock, right here at John Sessions Stadium.
Might take a turkey. I'm on here right now, I'm going.
No, we're just, they're going to wait till the inning rolls over.
By 3 Florida on top. Bottom of the third upcoming. Dolphins with an early three-run lead thanks to a hot start in the first. Two in the second, three in the third, and Florida has come from behind to take the top spot on the scoreboard. And Timmy Manning out now working with a lead for the first time tonight. The southpaw had 32 pitches so far. Had a 1-2-3 inning his last time out. And he gets 2-3-4 in the Jacksonville lineup. This time around, Pacheco, Jalila, Grabski do up. Alongside Chris Lehane, I'm Scott Manzi. As we work to the bottom of the third, we do believe we'll have a pause after this. We had an issue with the fuse blowing with some of the lights out in right field and on the right down the first baseline as well. So they're going to eventually at some point here tonight shut down the lights, replace the fuse, and then power them back up. So we'll keep you all posted on that. First pitch into Pacheco is a fastball outside. For ball one, Pacheco struck out on three straight pitches, all breaking balls, his first time up back in the first. The 1-0. And that is hit high in the air out into the right side and foul by a long shot for Pacheco. Jesus Pacheco, one of a collection of youngsters that have really solidified themselves in this lineup. The 1-1 pitch is a fastball high. He, along with Jackson Grabski down at third, Trace Burchard, who's starting behind the plate tonight, as well as Blake DeLamiller, who's not in the lineup here this evening, but all true freshmen, and all of them have played a lot here this year. The 2-1 pitch, foul ball off the foot of Pacheco to even the count. And Chris, I can't remember off the top of my head the last time we saw four true freshmen playing significant action in the field. Now, we've seen a lot of youngsters pitch, but not a ton of position guys, usually.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was, my junior year when Ruben and them came in?
Yes, so Ruben Samayan as a pitch misses in to load the count.
So it was
Ruben, Scott DeBrule.
You had, Duncan came in.
No, that was
the
year before. Running through the lineup in my mind, and I think those are the only two freshmen that really saw significant action.
You had a couple pitchers. You had Santana throw in the bullpen that year. And then my senior year, you had Trent Palmer in the bullpen. You had Maloney in the bullpen.
3-2 fisted to the right side into shallow right field. Just a step into the grass. Corey Acton makes the catch behind the bag at first for round number one.
Yeah, but from a lineup perspective, it's been a while. And it's exciting. I obviously, the year isn't going the way they want, but it's also it's also, you know, a light at the end of the tunnel to say, hey, we got a future here, you know, and this season's not over. You never know what's going to happen in the tournament and
exactly.
the rest of the season.
Work.
And then, yeah, like you said, that's why they play it. But look, you have to look in the future because you got to take care of the program.
First pitch, breaking ball, and Dakota Jung Island nearly swung out of his spikes on that one. Falls behind. Nothing in one.
And you see what happens when you develop these young guys. You see what happens. Dakota Jalila came in his freshman year. And he got
started as a true freshman day one.
And Ruben Samayan, Scott DeBrule. I know he's not here. He's at Mississippi State doing his thing. And these are all guys that they might not have the All-American freshman years that you see, you know, Mike Bauman have. But they're going to compete, and they're going to get better.
0-1 pitch grounded right at the third baseman, Halter, who pats twice, throws across the diamond, and retires Jalila for out number two. Base is empty, two gone. Jackson Grabsky, who was hit by a pitch his first time up, climbs into the box, and as darkness continues to settle here over John Sessions Stadium, it has become more noticeable about some of those lights that are out here tonight. There just feels like there's a shade over the right side of the field versus the left side.
Remember what I was saying earlier about the fields?
Yeah. High major versus mid-major.
Yeah, you know, it happens. We're not the only school.
No. This is first pitch misses into Grabsky. And these lights, for those that don't know, were purchased as a gift by George Steinbrenner back in the 80s. It was the former and the late great president of Jacksonville University, Fran Kinney, as a fastball misses in to Grabsky 2-0, who convinced Mr. Steinbrenner to donate the money. And apparently, those that know Dr. Kinney and knew Dr. Kinney and knew that she could be a very persuasive woman. And George Steinbrenner, another pitch nearly hits Grabsky. Bounced right through his legs.
That's the same. That's the same thing. He was the one who got hit on that.
Yeah, it was.
That's the same. It's the same pitch, except it was a. Was that a fastball or is that another breaking
ball? He just overthrew
a.
He yanked a fastball.
Yeah, it went and he was ready for it and it went through his legs.
3-0 with two outs to Grabsky, and that is a called strike on the inner half. The lights were put in. All of a sudden, a chance to start playing some night games here in the 80s as the program really ascended under Tom Bradley and then Terry Alexander when he took over for him. The 3-1 pitch down in the dirt, ball four. And Grabsky walks, second time he's been on base tonight, and that continues the third inning here. But maybe the moral of the story is, well, these lights are older than I am and older than you are. And it's just how technology goes when it ages some.
And lights are not cheap. I know they're.
No,
I know they're on the top of Coach Hayes' Christmas list. So, if there's anybody out there that's feeling generous,
no doubt. No, that's not a routine.
Yeah,
type
that's
purchase.
Yeah, that's not buying you new uniforms.
Uh-uh.
That is an investment.
True. Runner at first, two outs in the bottom of the third, 5-3 Florida leads, and Duncan Hunter takes a first pitch curveball in the inner half. He swung at the first pitch he saw and roped a double that cleared the bases into the left field corner back in the first inning. And that put Jacksonville ahead 3-0. Gators have scored 5 unanswered since then. The 1-0. Breaking ball down and in, and giving a look, Grabsky ends up putting the brakes on and retreating back to first. Greenfield, a good job behind the plate really tonight of keeping the ball close by. Dolphins have had a chance to advance a runner once on a wild pitch, but nothing more. And that was on a strikeout that rolled away, so he had to pick which base he was going to throw to. Here comes head coach and pitching coach Kevin O'Sullivan. And he wants to have a chat with Manning as he is approaching 50 pitches here on the night. There is a right-hander throwing down in the Gator bullpen in right field.
Want to hear something funny, Scott? I played against Sullivan for 5 years. I worked here for 2 years and watched them play Kevin O'Sullivan for 2 years.
Yeah.
And now watching him again, I did not know he was their pitching coach.
I
didn't know that.
He has his hands, I should say, firmly.
I didn't know that.
In the pie.
No idea.
Former catcher, so, you know, that's how it goes a lot of times. You know, it's not only former pitchers that do that. 2-0 pitch after the mound visit misses inside.
Thought he was just the head guy.
But if you notice it, nobody else ever makes visits. He's the only one.
No.
I mean, it obviously it's really not the top of your priority list over the years. Yeah. You probably had other things to worry about. 3-0 pitch and a green light for Duncan Hunter, who grounds one foul to the left side.
I know who their assistant coach is.
Yeah, you know a little bit about Chuck Drolleman down there.
Yeah. Yeah, he's Coach Jay, as we called him. Chuck Drolleman came here from TCU, and as 3-1 to Duncan Hunter goes fastball up and away, from swinging strike two. Chuck Drolleman came here from TCU, and he brought a lot. I mean, not only did he bring a lot of good players recruiting, but he brought a great mindset to every position on the field, whether it was the infielders, the outfielders, and he just taught a lot of the game and how the game is played correctly and hard, and a lot of respect for Coach Jay and what he did for us.
Runner goes on a 3-2 pitch that is scalded over to the Jacksonville dugout off the railing and down the left field line.
And what a lot of people don't see is what the day in and day out just – he's just teaching you, especially the young guys, how to grow up. I mean, he was my coach for my first 4 years here, and, you know, I came in with absolutely no chance of getting on the field, and he just pushed me every day. He's hard on you, but he loves you.
Breaking ball and a protective swing by Duncan Hunter to get a piece of that one to stay alive. And this has turned into a good at-bat. And, man, this is a guy who's been hitting well as of late. He's had stretches this season where you have seen – goodness gracious, the Duncan Hunter that is capable of existing. Talk about a toolsy guy. He has it all. And he's had an unconventional journey to this point as well, but seems to be putting things together. 3-2, ball four downstairs. They're trying to appeal down to first to see if he went around. Vic Correll confirms that he did not. Another walk to Hunter. Back-to-back men walked with two outs by Timmy Manning. And the inning continues for Trace Burchard. And here comes Kevin O'Sullivan, and that'll do it for Timmy Manning. So he goes 2 2/3, matching Mike Casala's start here tonight, and it's the free passes that doom him in the end as well. We'll step aside as they warm up a new Gator arm. A right-hander coming in out of the pen. 5-3, Florida on top as we work here in the bottom of the third. Jacksonville with two on and two out. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network. Can you iris up? Do we have a filter on or anything?
For the Gators, now pitching, number 55, Ben Speck.
New pitcher for Florida, the right-hander Ben Specht enters the ball game, replacing Timmy Manning, who goes 2 2/3 in the start here today. His third of his Gator career, is responsible for the men at first and second. He allowed 3 runs on just 3 hits. Did have a really nice stretch of strikeouts where he fanned 5 through the first 2 innings, but then walked a pair of batters with 2 outs here in the third, and that ended his night. He also hit one here this evening.
Yeah, he settled in after that first inning. I know he only went 2 2/3, but you know, he came out the second inning. He showed some maturity and got 3 big outs. Came out here again, got two big outs again, and couldn't finish the inning. But you know, he came out here. He did his job. You'd like to see him get as a Florida coach, you'd like to see him get that last one. But I would guess that Ben Specht is in here to get one out, and then you probably will go deeper in the pen next inning. I believe that's probably the job here. Get this out, get out of this inning, and move on. I mean, this is a guy that hasn't thrown since late March.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's maybe a little bit of nerves, trying to work his way back into the weekend bullpen. So, you know, it'd be interesting to see if he comes right after Trace Burchard here.
Expecting his sixth appearance of the year, the right-handed sophomore from Fort Myers. With runners at first and second and two outs, his first pitch to Burchard, a fastball inside of the right-hander for ball one. Expect 10 innings, 12 hits, 10 runs allowed, 6 strikeouts, 3 walks. Gators leading 5-3 in the bottom of the third. 1-0, and he locates on the outside corner to Burchard, who is 0-for-1 here tonight, struck out back in the first inning, making his first career start behind the plate tonight. Caught his first game as a Dolphin last Tuesday. He has seen most of his action either in left field or as a designated hitter this season to this point. The 1-1. Swung on and tipped foul by Burchard. Dolphins have so many catchers technically on the roster. It was funny because due to NCAA rules, you can only have so many people listed at so many different positions, right? So Coach Hayes calls me before the season, and hopefully nobody's listening, I guess, to turn us in. But he's like, we got to take some of these guys off catchers. I won't say who they are, but you know, Burchard is a guy who came in as a freshman, and an injury to Jake Berg, a couple of injuries to Jake Berg have opened up the door a little bit here, and he's getting a chance to show what he can do behind the dish tonight. 1-2 pitch. He takes a little bit outside for ball two. He had a 4-hit game 2 weeks ago against FGCU as well. I mean, they really like the way he can swing it. His numbers don't, you know, jump off the page at you per se. He enters today hitting 231, 12 for 52 on the season, now 12 for 53. But he's a guy that shows some promise, that's for sure. And another youngster who we didn't even document earlier, 2-2 pitch. Gets just a piece of it to stay alive.
Yeah, and this is that freshman year I was talking about. There, you know, you're nothing is gonna light it up on a piece of paper, but you know, it's the experience. It's getting to see Division I pitching day in, day out. It's getting to know the speed of the game and how the game is played. It's gonna go a long way. You know, we saw a lot of that. Like a guy like maybe like Connor Stevens, you know, yeah. He wasn't in the lineup every day, but he had a great freshman year, yeah. that helped him throughout the rest of his career.
2-2 pitch with two on and two out, and another foul ball by Burchard as he slaps one to the left side. Tyler Santana quickly out of the dugout to beat his veteran counterpart Jagger McCoy to that foul ball.
Yeah, Tyler Santana wearing eye black and wrist tape tonight. Gotta love the weekend pitchers. And
when you know you're not going to appear. Of course, last week, all three weekend guys threw because, or I should say two and a half maybe with Casala because he was still working his way back. It was a situation where the Dolphins kind of knew they might not play on the weekend, so wanted to get him some work. I'm sure he didn't look like that last weekend. Ground ball hits softly up the middle, charging in on Rivera, scoops and throws on the run, a strike to first, and an excellent play by the sensational shortstop for the Florida Gators to end the inning and strand a couple of base runners on. Dolphins threaten but cannot get back any closer to Florida. 5-3, Gators lead it as we head to the fourth. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Two left on base. The score after three innings of play, Florida 5, Jacksonville 3. Black Knight is the mortgage and finance industry's leading provider of integrated technology, data, and analytics solutions that facilitate and automate many of the business processes across the mortgage lifecycle. Black Knight, a proud partner of Jacksonville Athletics.
Oh, I thought it was lightning every time I was watching it.
Three in the books here on this Tuesday night. Alongside Chris Lehane, I'm Scott Manzi. Tyler Nauman back out to work. as we continue to work through this midweek affair between the Florida Gators and the Jacksonville Dolphins, fourth meeting this year between the two teams. Jacksonville won the first matchup on a Friday night back in early March, March 12th, a 10-9 slobber knocker of an affair, back and forth throughout the night. And then the Gators took the next two to win the series. It was not close on Saturday, 9-0 win for Florida, but a very competitive game on Sunday. Florida wins that one 5-2.
That was probably the Dolphins, outside of the sweep, the Dolphins, one of the Dolphins' best series of the year.
First pitch swinging, and Nathan Hickey lifts one high into the air in shallow center field. Samayan on the run, and he ends up taking the ball from right in front of the left fielder, Heffron. I mean, that's a center fielder. He says, I got it. You got to let him go. But he went a long way to get it.
Yeah, it's one of those ones where you just got to trust your fifth-year center fielder who, I mean.
He's made more putouts than anybody can imagine.
You just, and it's the old, you know, the thing you learn when you're 12 years old, that center fielder has priority.
Just give him the
space. If he calls it, he's got it. Now he's got to catch it, and I don't think that's a problem with our center fielder.
First pitch is a fastball on the outside edge of the right-handed swinging DH, Kirby McMullen, who's been on base twice here tonight, singled in the first, walked and scored in the third. Tyler Nauman. Now for a second inning of relief work, and off the end of the bat, McMullen down the right field line into foul territory. Kyle Richardson running out of room, but he makes the catch as he crashes into the fence. And an excellent play by Richardson for out number two.
I don't think the lights are that big of a problem. I mean, that's the first test we've seen over
on
the right side.
Well, you know, Chris, it looks like, correct me if I'm wrong, most of them have come back on.
Yeah, I think.
One there, maybe two there.
If you look at them, I was actually thinking that. I was like, well, a lot of them are on. Why is it if you look at the left field lights with the right field lights, some of the right field ones just aren't as bright.
Yeah, yeah.
You can kind of see that. The tint isn't as strong. The brightness hasn't been turned all the way up. But, I mean, it's definitely playable. I mean, come on. We're baseball players. We've played on worse high school fields. These guys are fine.
First pitch to Fabian is a called strike. Next one misses low. One ball, one strike to Judd Fabian with the bases empty and two outs. 5-3. Florida leads it. Top of the fourth. Most of the darkness appears to be in the stands. Interestingly enough, like it feels darker than usual in the stands tonight as another one misses high, making it 2-1. Allows guys like Jeff Tanner to operate under the darkness of the night when he does his best work.
I tried to get Jeff to come up here for an inning. We're going to have Angelo Amendolari coming up here after the fourth inning.
Check swing appeal down to first. He did not go around. It went from 0-1 on Fabian to 3-1 on Fabian. And Nauman has, it's the two outs. That have tripped up Tyler Nauman at times this year. He worked around it well last week at the Citadel. A check swing, and that ball's put in play to the right side, but nobody's there. Richardson fields, tosses to the uncovering Nauman underhanded, and Fabian is able to beat it to the bag.
That's an awkward play right there. You get a check swing that, you know, as a pitcher, you're not expecting that kind of contact from a non-bunt. He takes that. He's aggressive towards the ball. Realizes he can't get there, and then first baseman Richardson realized that he couldn't get there. So they kind of had that stall in the middle of, all right, you got the ball now. I don't have to worry about it. And then Nauman. Then it took him. It delayed a second that he had to cover first base. It's one of those ones you can't really teach. You teach it on a bunt that you know your brain kind of triggers it. But it's those check swings. That's a tough play. Yeah. I mean, you got to get over and got to cover your position. But that's a tough one.
Sterling Thompson takes low to start the at-bat, 1-0, and another infield single for the Gators. And that extends this inning. Dolphins have not had a clean inning yet. Gators have had a base runner in every one so far as we work here in the fourth. 1-0 pitch bounces away, kicks off of the catcher's gear of Trace Burchard off to the right side, and it allows Fabian to scoot down to second base. He's now in scoring position with two outs.
That's a big pitch right there. You know, you're not only are you in a 2-0 hitter's count and you got to go right after him, but now you got a base runner in scoring position. This is the conversation we had earlier about hitting with two outs. It's a little less pressure. The field opens up now with the runner in scoring position, and you know, I would expect a free swing right here trying to do damage.
2-0 pitch. Ooh. That one looked pretty good. A fastball called strike at the letters, but I was fully expecting to see Thompson swing that one.
Yeah, it's a fastball up in the zone. Maybe not what Thompson was looking for. Maybe he's looking something middle. You know, maybe it just depends. 2-0, you want to come unglued on a ball. You want to try to do damage, hit a double. But if it's not your pitch, then you got two more strikes to work with. You live to fight another day. And I would expect him to be just as aggressive the rest of that bat until he falls behind.
2-1 pitch, breaking ball stays upstairs.
And for that reason right there. You know, you don't go after a pitch that you're not sure about, 2-0, knowing that he's got to come back to you again to get to 2-2. And you saw right there, Nauman can't complete the strike, and now you're back in a hitter's count. And this is probably one of the most comfortable counts to hit in a 3-1 count. He's got to come to you. He doesn't want to put you on.
Two outs, runner at second base. Sterling Thompson, who's already homered and singled here tonight. 3-1 pitch, fastball low, and a walk issued to Thompson. And the inning continues. Two quick outs, an infield single, a walk, and the Gators threatening to add to their lead here in the fourth, already a two-run advantage, 5-3.
Not the worst case scenario there for Nauman. Not what you want to see as a two-out walk, putting another base runner on, especially behind in a game. If you're pitching with the lead, it's not as big of a deal, but when you're playing from behind, you want to try to attack with two outs and get the lineup back to the plate. But not the worst thing that could happen. No damage done there. You still got what's in front of you. You still only got one out to go, and I would just be aggressive, hit your spots, and make them make the defense make a play.
Josh Rivera standing in, 0-for-1 tonight, has drawn a walk and scored. First pitch he sees is a breaking ball that stays up. And Nauman, as innings have gone on, gotten more stressful. He has slowed his pace down, become more deliberate. He has thrown just two strikes in his last 11 pitches. And make that two in his last 12 pitches. Two and oh. And time called so that Jerry Edwards can go out to the mound and have a chat. Jacksonville's pitching coach to chat with Tyler Nauman and company, who all come in to the mound to convene. And for Nauman, man, you look back at those first two quick outs. He gets a fly out on the first pitch to Hickey this inning. And an 0-1 pop up into foul territory, Kirby McMullen. But then, again, it feels repetitive, but it's when he's gotten in trouble is when he's fallen behind hitters. And fell behind Fabian, 3-1, a check swing. I mean, it's still a pretty good pitch. He just wasn't able to get the out there. Bad break for him, certainly, but falls behind Thompson. Now has fallen behind Rivera. This lineup is just so dangerous. You're almost giving them house money to work with, it feels like.
Yeah, and this is what I was afraid of, and you mentioned it when the first batter got on, is that third out for Nauman has been his kryptonite, and he's struggling with it right now, and he's fallen behind 2-0, and now Rivera's in a hitter's count, and you know, you hope that he helps you out here. You hope that he misses a barrel or he reaches after a pitch he shouldn't, gets a little too over aggressive, but if he gets his pitch, I would expect Rivera to do some damage.
2-0, fastball at the knees, called strike one. So a big first strike there for Tyler Nauman. Trying to battle his way back and get out of this inning without allowing a run. Dolphins haven't held the Gators off the scoreboard since the first. Trailing 5-3 in the top of the four. Two outs, two on. And a 2-1 count to the Gator shortstop, Rivera, who stands with a slightly closed stance from the right side and swings at a low fastball, fouling it straight back. 2-2.
It's a great job by Nauman here, fighting back. This is a huge pitch, probably the biggest pitch of the ballgame so far.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Nauman has the sign he wants from Burchard. A look back to second comes home. Breaking ball swung on and missed, and a big strikeout for Nauman to end the inning and strand a couple of men on. Second time he has done that with a strikeout, leaving men in scoring position. He has stranded five on himself through his first two innings of work, inning and a third to be exact. And we head to the bottom of the fourth. 5-3, Florida on top. Jacksonville's Corey Heffron leads it off when we return. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Florida 5, Jacksonville 3. Take your team travel in a new direction with Sport Travel. Play the world's best golf courses. Follow your favorite team on the road, or work with our team to plan your perfect trip. Whether you're a team, college, or fan, Sport Travel can help you plan the trip or season of a lifetime. Ask about our unique sponsorship programs that can help make travel even more affordable. Go to www.sporttravel.com. Just right. I know you didn't buy them like that. So baby, don't even try that. You dance. Oh, you move. Like there ain't nobody watching. Girl, you know I'm watching. Don't lie. For the Dolphins. Now batting the left fielder, number 18, Corey Heffron.
Florida leads it, bottom of the fourth inning here at John Sessions Stadium. Jacksonville's bottom third of the order coming up. Corey Heffron leading things off. Second time he has come up today as he faces Ben Specht here to start the fourth. First pitch swinging and a fly ball out into center field. A couple of steps back for Judd Fabian, and he camps out underneath, reaches up, squeezes it, out number one in the books. Specht got the final out of the third inning. It took him a while to get it as Trace Burchard battled nicely. But after a couple of walks, end of the inning for for Timmy Manning. Specht now getting a chance to work here in the fourth. One out, bases empty. Stephen Moffitt, the DH, 0 for 1. And he takes inside near the kneecaps for ball one on a tailing fastball on the inside of the plate. The 1-0, and that is a fastball down and outside to Moffitt, who has a tendency to draw some walks in his career. Four so far this year, .308 on base percentage. His on base percentage is well over .400 last year as he lines one down the right field line and toward the Gator bullpen, where it lands beyond the fence in foul territory. Two balls and a strike to the redshirt junior from DeLand. Two-one pitch hit off the end of the bat down toward first base, where it is scooped nicely by Hickey off a low second hop, and he takes it himself to the bag at first for out number two.
Yeah, speaking of DeLand, Florida, Austin Hayes making his former Dolphin that I played with, Austin Hayes making his return from the injured list today for the Orioles, making a great play out in right field to save a run possibly against the Marlins down in Miami. So good to see Austin back in the lineup. Good to see him back on the field. I mean, the guy has just had some bad luck lately.
Yeah.
Probably the best baseball player I've ever played with. And, you know, you're just hoping he's going to have so much success up there for the Orioles.
Bases empty, two outs. First pitch to Kyle Richardson, a fastball that misses away. And, by the way, as a guy who used to live in Port Orange, Florida, I take offense to you describing that as DeLand.
It's the same area.
It is.
It's area-ish.
Yeah, Port Orange is definitely more Daytona.
He's from
Coast.
He's from Seminole.
Closer. He went to Spruce Creek, so that's right there where
whatever.
I played my.
That's like Reagan Wright getting mad saying he's from Jacksonville. He's from Callahan.
2-0 pitch.
I hope you're listening.
Swing and a miss. There's a big difference there. Nassau County, trust me, I know. Nassau County, not Duval County.
I'm waiting for the text from Reagan.
He's a West Nassau product himself, Reagan Wright, former two sport athlete there. 2-1 pitch, swung on and missed. Yeah, Port Orange Spruce Creek, where we saw Austin Hayes play. I played youth soccer there back in the mid-90s. 2-2 pitch. Fastball misses away. Full count now. I don't know. I don't think I put on displays quite to the level of what Austin Hayes did playing baseball there, but I like to think that I was pretty good for my U8 soccer league. Full count, and that hits Richardson. I might have got him on the ribs.
It's not a good place to get hit.
Yeah, that one just knocks the wind out of you and just doesn't feel good. And Richardson earns first base the hard way and extends the inning. Back to the top of the order, Ruben Simayan coming to the plate. Specht, second man he's hit this year. Boy, how many two out base runners have we seen tonight? Where an inning has gone from clean to not clean in a matter of an errant pitch here or there. Both sides.
Yeah, that's those midweek games,
midweek
Scott.
Midweek games, right?
Never know what's going to happen. Anything's in play.
Simayan 1-for-2, and he watches the first pitch miss low.
I'll tell you what, that's why baseball plays series, because one game in the middle of the week, and I know you don't got any of your dudes on the mound throwing, but it's a coin flip, especially when you have two talented teams.
1-0 pitch. Runner goes. Pitch is outside for a ball. The throw down to second. One hops to Rivera, who had to reach up for it before applying the tag, and Richardson swipes second.
Hey, and now that, I mean, the Dolphins are in a great position here. You got, that's a big stolen base there from Richardson. You're kind of doing it with,
Well, you're manufacturing it,
you know,
really.
No risk, high reward there. I mean, if you get thrown out, you got the top of your lineup coming up, and now you got a 2-0 count for Simayan, and Richardson standing on second base, and he's got the speed. If Simayan puts a ball in the outfield, then, you know, it's a one-run game.
2-0 pitch. Simayan takes inside this time, and Specht has had a hard time with the zone here in this at-bat. Three balls, no strikes to Ruben Simayan, the top of the order. Ruben, with runners in scoring position this year, has not hit particularly well. Has been much better with just runners on, but we'll see if he can come through and deliver an RBI. He takes ball four and low, doesn't need to. He goes down to first, and now the task shifts over to Jesus Pacheco.
This is eerily similar to last inning, the last half of the inning with the Gators, and you see Sullivan's going to make the trip to the bullpen. He's already waved for the right-hander.
Yeah, right-hander coming in to replace Ben Specht, who hits one, walks one, and his day comes to a close with two outs and two on in the bottom of the fourth. 5-3, Florida leading, but Jacksonville threatening. We'll introduce you to the new Gator arm when we return from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Gators, now pitching, number 8, Brandon Sproul.
Brandon Sproat takes over on the mound, relieving Ben Specht, who is responsible for the men at first and second. Specht, in exactly one inning of work, hits one and walks one. And that is his line so far here tonight, hoping that he cannot add to the ERA if his teammate can pick him up. That is Brandon Sproat, who gets the call out of the pen, the third pitcher to use tonight by the Florida Gators, and another right-hander for head coach Kevin O'Sullivan out of the pen. A freshman, redshirt freshman from Pace, Florida, 6'3".
Jesus Pacheco.
And he inherits two men on with Jesus Pacheco coming to the plate. Sproat, 12th appearance of the year, all out of the pen. Opponents hitting 298 off of him, 9 strikeouts, 7 walks, and Pacheco looking for his first base hit of the night, the freshman second baseman, 0 for 2. Richardson with good wheels at second base. Ruben Simayan, who runs well as well, over at first. Two outs, the pitch, and a big swing and a miss on an inside fastball tipped into the mitt of the catcher Greenfield for strike one. 5-3, Florida leads it. Pacheco, who has produced in these type of spots, 12 RBI. Tied for second on the team. The 0-1. And he fouls one straight back. A low fastball that time. Pacheco takes a walk behind the plate. And readjusts the batting gloves before climbing back in. Third base coach Brad Wilkerson pointing down to Kyle Richardson at second base after getting the sign from the Jacksonville dugout and head coach Chris Hayes. Dolphins trying to erase a two-run deficit here in the bottom of the fourth with a two-out rally. The 0-2 pitch. Runner goes and a line drive into right field. That falls in and rolls toward the corner. Richardson scoring easily. Samayan being waved around. The throw to Acton. Acton's relay onto the plate is not in time. Diving into third, Pacheco safely. And we're tied at 5. A double with 2 driven in for Jesus Pacheco. Takes third on the throw and has a chance to give Jacksonville the lead if the Dolphins can come up with another base hit here that reminiscent a little of his big double down in Gainesville earlier this year in which he played at a pair.
Yeah, what a huge swing there from Pacheco. I mean, he's not knotted this game up and putting himself in scoring position and also third base, not that – you know, a base hit scores when he's at second base either way, but I might even put that as a triple. He was going 3 no matter what. I mean, it depends on what the official score decides here, but I mean, a great job there by Pacheco putting something in play with 2 strikes and behind 0-2 for that matter.
Well, we all know who the real official score is, so we'll wait and see on that one. But he is standing at third nonetheless with Dakota Jalil at the plate, a 1-0 pitch, and he spoils one hard and foul to the right side.
Were the runners moving there?
Yeah, at least the lead runner was.
Yeah, well, no, because they were both moving, and that was huge with Samayan. I want to say Samayan scores if he's not moving, but that's huge there, putting the runners in motion there.
Another 1-1 foul ball out of play to the right side. Jalila trying to put Jacksonville back on top here at a tie game at 5 as the Dolphins have played a 2 in the fourth. Next to Jesus Pacheco's RBI base hit. He now has 14 driven in this year. The 1-2. Swing, and they say a miss off the end of the bat. I thought maybe at first by Jalila, but he heads down to first base and is thrown out easily by Greenfield to end the inning. But Jesus Pacheco produces, and we are tied again at 5 as we head to the fifth. Jacksonville and Florida, and it is former Jacksonville middle infielder Angelo Amendolari that joins us when we return. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Jacksonville 5, Florida 5. Fans, please make sure you are wearing your face mask or face covering throughout your time at John Sessions Stadium this evening. Also, please make sure you are adhering to social distancing protocols. We appreciate your attention and consideration to this matter.
We head to the fifth inning, all tied up at 5, thanks to Jesus Pacheco's big RBI double there to knot things up in the bottom of the fourth. Scott Manzi now joined by another former Dolphin middle infielder, Angelo Amendolari. Ange, thanks for joining me here on the broadcast tonight.
Thank you, Scott, for having me. I appreciate it. Good night for some baseball.
Very good night for baseball. I mean, beautiful weather, chance to get in the stands and watch games and have a little fun.
Yeah.
You and former teammate Jeff Tanner sitting down there. Anybody else in the?
Yeah, we're sporting the guys. You know, Lehane was obviously up here in the booth.
Ryan Quintero, of course,
Ryan
works
Quintero.
Here.
We got some alumni here tonight. So it's good to see some familiar faces.
Always. The fraternity reunited.
We're back. We're back.
Bottom third of the order for the Gators due up here in the fifth. It's Colby Halter leading things off. He is the one that broke the tie and gave the Gators a lead with his big two RBI, or he tied the game up, I should say, back in the third. Here's the 0-1.
Ooh.
That one just misses away to Halter as Tyler Nauman works here in the fifth. He's gone an inning and a third thus far, has not allowed a run to score thanks to some timely strikeouts with men in scoring position. The 1-1 pitch, and that is slapped foul to the right side.
Yeah, it's a big inning for him here. Tying the game up in the bottom half. You need to look for a good 1-2-3 inning right here.
If he is able to get it, it'd be the first of the night for the Jacksonville Dolphins. Gators have won. That was the second inning where Timmy Manning sat down the Dolphins in order, 8-9-1. Nauman, over 30 pitches now on the night. 1-2 pitch is lined the other way on the run. Heffron back toward the wall. It's over his head at a one hops to the warning track. Headed into second base, Colby Halter standing up with a leadoff double to start the fifth. And the hometown boy putting on a show in front of family and friends here tonight.
Yeah, this two-strike pitch right there, a little up in the zone. Got to do a little better with two strikes right there.
So a leadoff man on base for the third time tonight for Florida. Just the second time tonight for Florida. Fabian singled the leadoff the second inning. And then he came home to score on the home run from Sterling Thompson right after that. Now it's Corey Acton, who's been on base twice tonight, an RBI single and a walk so far, with an RBI opportunity again here with a man in scoring position and nobody out. First pitch from Nauman, misses down and outside.
Yeah, you don't get many breaks in the in this Gator lineup. You know, a lot of good bats come up to the plate.
Yeah, you see a guy like Halter hitting seventh, and you're sitting there going, man, he'd be hitting in the top three for just about every other lineup in the country.
Yep, that's for sure.
The 1-0. And that one is in for strike one at the knees to Acton. For Nauman, it's just he has sort of lived life in the dirty here this year, if that makes any sense. I mean, they're just he falls behind guys, and then he battles back. He just almost is more comfortable when he's uncomfortable, I guess you could say.
Yeah, a lot of tough ABs. Not too many, you know, 1-2-3s here. Kind of works in and out of the count. Definitely a lot of high pressure at bats.
Breaking ball misses in 2-1 now to Acton. The catcher Cal Greenfield on deck. He's been on base twice tonight. The bottom third of the order for the Gators has been very productive as they have out hit Jacksonville 9-4, but the score is tied at 5. The 2-1 pitch. Fastball misses low. So a runner at second, nobody out here in the fifth. Jacksonville does have action. Double-barreled action in the bullpen, a lefty and a righty going for the Dolphins. Nauman at 40 pitches. A glance back to second, 3-1 pitch, and he locates with a fastball at the knees. Catches the outside corner, yeah.
Pitcher's pitch. Definitely got to go after this guy right here.
So Acton, who had already started his way down to first, returns to the box. The left-handed swinging second baseman awaits a payoff pitch with nobody out and a runner at second. Nauman deals. And he hits it high in the air, out into left center field, going back on it, Heffron, carrying back to the wall, and it's off the base of the wall. Rounding third, heading home, Halter. The throw to the plate is not in time. The swipe tag from Burchard, and Halter just beats it. And an RBI double for Corey Acton the other way. And Florida retakes the lead 6-5.
Really good relay in there from left. It's just like you said, Scott, getting behind hitters. A lot of them are in hitters counts. Get some up in the zone. That's kind of what happens when you face a good lineup like this.
Boy, that ball just kept carrying, too. I mean, off the bat, it just sort of looked like a fly ball out to left field, and it's not like there's necessarily wind carrying the ball here tonight, but that just had more barrel on it than I initially realized.
Yeah, put a good swing on it. He backspun that ball, carried a little bit. Yeah, the flag's not moving out there in center field.
No, unlike we saw a couple of weekends ago where it just felt like every ball that got up in the slipstream was gone. First pitch and a bunt put down by Greenfield down the third base line, and it is foul about halfway up the line. Trying to move the runner Acton over. Still nobody out here in the fifth. 6-5, Florida has quickly retaken the lead after Jacksonville tied it up in the bottom of the fourth. Greenfield has a single and has drawn a walk here tonight.
It looks like he is bunting. Up in the box, choked up a little bit.
Infield ready to crash in at the corners. Jalila holding the runner on at short. Another bunt shown and a called strike as Greenfield pulls the bat back on a breaking ball in the outer half.
It's a good pitch there, 0-2. Got to be good here with 0-2. Got to get something down in the zone.
Nothing in two, Nauman ahead of the hitter, the nine-hole hitter, and a guy who Jacksonville pitchers have had a hard time getting out tonight. You'd love to get that first out of the inning before the top of the order comes back up. 0-2 pitch, swung on and missed, elevated a fastball, and Greenfield at the last second decided to swing. And that was not a great at-bat for Cal Greenfield. Couldn't get the bunt down, changed his mind on a what would have been a pretty good pitch to bunt, and then swings and misses. But Jacksonville takes advantage. That is the third strikeout of the night for Tyler Nauman. One out top of the order coming up with a runner at second.
Yeah, big run there at second base.
Yeah, the difference between one and two, right? I mean,
big
when you
difference.
Know you can change things with one swing of the bat versus having to get that guy on.
Oh, yeah.
So here's Jacob Young, 0 for 3 tonight. A throwback to second base and nearly picks off Acton. He just got his hand back in under the tag of Pacheco. Pacheco, he's a youngster. You played middle infield. You know, I feel like you can sell some of those sometimes in the way you receive them and you kind of look
with it.
First pitch in here is a fastball down and away, ball one.
Yeah, anytime I tagged the guy, it made it look like he was out, even if he was safe by a mile. You know, you have to, there's a sell to it.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you might catch an umpire. You know, the big league games, the replays and everything won't work. But
yeah.
Fair game.
Pacheco, who says that he is a big fan of Javier Baez, who is a guy who has almost made the art of tagging cool in a way.
I'll tell you, he was a fun guy to watch.
1-0 pitch into the right side, and a leaping attempt made by Richardson, but it gets over his glove into right field. Holding up at third, Acton. The throw comes into the plate from Duncan Hunter, and the runner holds it first as well. Young, runners now at the corners with one out.
Not a whole lot of harm there. I mean, double play still in order. Lefty-lefty matchup looks like here.
For the Gators, now batting the first
wouldn't
base.
Be surprised if the Number Gators 11, get somebody moving Hickey. At first base to try to get out of the double play here.
Especially because Hickey has hit a couple on the ground over to the right side here tonight. A couple of 3-1 putouts when Mike Casala was pitching against him. He flew out against Nauman in his only previous at-bat against the Jacksonville Southpaw.
Yeah. Wouldn't be surprised here with some movement over at first base pretty early.
First pitch is a fastball at the belt for a strike. Tried the outer half and located perfectly. Nauman getting ahead of Hickey here, who has been aggressive. He has swung at the first pitch in each of his last two plate appearances, but takes that one. Nauman kicks the leg up high, delivers the 0-1, tries to locate on the outside corner, maybe tried to get Hickey to chase away there as he misses about a ball off and evens the count at 1-1.
Yeah, wouldn't be surprised with some action here, even a fake steal or something. Just get the defense moving around, 1-1 count.
Acton at third, Young who runs well at first, the 1-1 pitch, a check swing by Hickey. On a breaking ball that missed down in the dirt outside to the left of the plate. 2-1 now. And no appeal down to Art Thigpen standing down at second base. I mean, I I don't know how the umpire down at second would have any better view than the umpire behind home plate on that one anyway.
It's a coin toss for a lot of times.
2-1 pitch. Another breaking ball, and that is called strike two, top of the zone.
Good pitch there. It's a big at-bat here for both sides.
We work in kind of the middle part of this ball game. Florida's already broken the deadlock that did not last very long. But they have their eyes set on a big inning here. Acton dancing down at third base, and Burchard takes time behind the plate. Signs coming in from third again. And the Gators ready to go. 2-2 pitch hit high in the air out to deep left field. Heffron going back on it to the warning track to the wall. Leaping, and it's off the wall. Bouncing away from him. An easy scoring opportunity for Acton. Going first to third is Young, and a double of the RBI variety for Nathan Hickey as the Gators have played wall ball out and left this entire inning.
Yeah, the ball is, I mean, it somehow carrying out the left field today. I mean, with no wind, just seems like it's really taken off.
And here comes head coach Chris Hayes, and a quick sign to the bullpen, a right-hander coming in to relieve Tyler Nauman, who is done getting one out here in the fifth. He goes 2 2/3 of relief here tonight. So runners at second and third, it's 7-5. Florida leads it over Jacksonville, and the right-hander Sam Brunig enters for Jacksonville. We'll let him get loose. One out here in the fifth from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network. New pitcher for Jacksonville is Sam Brunig, the big right-hander, the transfer from Embry-Riddle. He replaces Tyler Nauman, who is responsible for the men at second and third right now. And the Gator lineup, they exploded here in this fifth inning. Angelo Amendolare, back-to-back doubles to lead off the inning off the wall and left, and then a couple of more out that way. They have three doubles here this inning, have driven in a pair of runs and lead it 7-5 now.
Yeah, I mean, pitching from behind, that's, you know, when you face a good lineup like this, you got to get ahead early. I mean, coming out of the bullpen, this situation right here, you want nothing more than throwing strikes. I mean, if they're hitting the ball, it's, you know, it is what it is, but you got to come in throwing strikes, getting ahead of the count. Being behind, that's what you expect when you face a good lineup like this.
So Brunig in to face the right-handed swinging DH, Kirby McMullen, with runners at second and third and a 7-5 lead for Florida. Jacksonville had just tied it up in the bottom of the fourth. And this almost has a little bit of the feelings of that Friday night game down in Gainesville back on the 12th of March, in which teams were just trading runs and blows throughout the course of the night. Ended up being a 10-9 final. 12 hits for Florida here tonight. And I rubbed my eyes to look at that hit total for Jacksonville. 4. It almost doesn't even feel real.
Yeah.
And have 5 runs to show for it. First pitch from Brunig is a fastball that goes off of the glove of Burchard. Caroms hard off the wall behind home plate, and that saved Jacksonville. Young took a couple of steps toward the toward home plate, but was unable to really get enough of a break on that one. Realized it was going to be way too close. Don't run into a second out, and holds up.
Yeah, that's a tough read there for a base runner. Seeing an automatic pass ball, it's hard right there to lay up, but he did a good job over there at third base.
Runners is second and third, one out. 1-0 count on McMullen, who is 1-for-2 tonight with a walk and a run scored. The 1-0. Fastball misses in.
Yeah, so what were we talking about here? You know, 2-0 count. Coming out of the bullpen, it's tough. I mean, you're putting these hitters in a good situation to hit.
Especially quality hitters, the likes of this lineup. I mean, here's your three-hole hitter, Kirby McMullen, for Florida. Hitting 256 on the year, is driven at 29 and has a golden opportunity for more here. 2-0 pitch. He takes a big cut at a fastball away and misses 2-1.
Good pitch in there, gets you some confidence. You know, throwing a strike there, 2-0. Hopefully gets into rhythm here.
Two-one pitch, fastball down at the knees. In for a strike. 2 balls, 2 strikes to the Gator DH. 7-5, Florida on top.
A little deceptive delivery here.
Yeah, he does. It's kind of hitches a couple of times,
wacky,
right?
But you know what? I mean, I'm all for it. Definitely makes it more difficult on the hitter.
Brunig making his first appearance since the 10th of April at FGCU, where he went an inning and 2/3. Infield comes crashing in on a breaking ball that slipped out of the hand of Brunig, and McMullen has to duck out of the way of it. Full count.
Yeah, everything seems to be up in the zone right now. We'll see here. We got the infield. Looks like they're halfway. One out. That run on third base probably going on contact.
Deep breath, and the pitch. Payoff pitch that hits McMullen right at the top of the 5 on the back of the 52 in his jersey. And that sends McMullen down to first to load up the bases, and pitching coach Jerry Edwards, who has certainly gotten his steps in tonight, heads out to the mound again. Wants to have a chat with his right-hander, Sam Brunig, who, yeah, the 2 strikes he threw, very good pitches. The other ones, not so much, and they weren't even close misses, unfortunately.
Yeah, he was a little erratic in warm-ups. I mean, he just has to get some confidence here, get back in the zone. Get back in the zone early to set the tone for him.
Coach Hayes taking a moment to instruct the infield, too. You know, a unique infield here tonight where they really have 4 dynamic infielders, with Kyle Richardson playing over at first base, a shortstop by trade.
Yeah.
And he wanted to make sure that everybody knew where they're going to the baseball here if it's hit to them. And it is Judd Fabian coming to the plate, who's already 2-for-3 tonight, but hasn't driven in a run yet. He can change that here. Bases loaded. Gators have left some men on here tonight. They left them loaded back in the third, have left a total of 7 men on base of their first 4 innings. Jacksonville hoping to strand a trio of Florida base runners again here in the fifth. 7-2, Florida on top, 1 out. And Sam Brunig with his work cut out for him facing Judd Fabian. Righty on righty matchup. After the mound visit, the first pitch, and it is popped up behind the plate and headed for the seats.
Yeah, he came out of his shoes on that one. Got something in the zone, and he was going to give it all he's got right there.
He was thinking long ball.
Yeah.
Probably figuring fastball with a guy who'd been a little erratic, right?
Yeah, especially after a mound visit like that. 9 times out of 10, they're coming fastball. That used to be my favorite time. When the time the pitching coach goes out there, I know a heater's coming right afterwards.
Bases loaded, 1 out. Brunig's 0-1. And he locates a fastball on the outer half, low and away from Fabian, who takes it for strike two.
I'll tell you what, when he's down in the zone, it's good.
Yes.
This is downhill. He has his funky delivery. When he's up, it flattens out. But if he gets down in the zone, that ball's got some downhill playing. It's tough to get the barrel on.
Young at third, Hickey at second, McMullen at first. Single, double, hit by pitch to load him up here. Gators have already played it to this inning. 0-2. And a fastball in on the hands of Fabian, taken for ball one. Brunig, the third pitcher used tonight by Jacksonville. 2 2/3 for Casala in the start. An inning and 2/3 for Nauman in relief. And now Sam Brunig hoping to give Jacksonville a couple here if he can. His longest outing of the year was 3 innings in his debut against Miami back in February in the opening weekend series against Miami University. Hasn't gone more than 2 2/3 since. Swing and a miss on a breaking ball in the inner half, and a great pitch by Brunig to get a much-needed strikeout for the second out of the inning.
Good pitch there. I mean, he's throwing 99% fastball, so no one's really seen what his breaking ball looked like right there. So definitely a good time for it.
So now it's Sterling Thompson, who has been very good here tonight. As you can say, for many of these Gator hitters who have combined for 12 hits on the evening, his two-run home run got the scoring started for Florida back in the second. Has also singled and walked here tonight. Is yet to be retired. Base is loaded, two outs. 7-2, Florida leads it. Brunig trying to keep Jacksonville within striking distance here in the fifth. First pitch breaking ball stays out to the left-handed swinging Thompson, ball one.
Yeah, big at-bat right here. I mean, two runs is manageable. This is definitely the guy you want to get right now.
Brunig walked a pair, allowed a hit and a run at FGCU. 2 weekends ago, had a third of an inning against Florida State. The Tuesday before that, the 1-0 pitch. On the ground right at the shortstop, Jalila. He flips to the covering Pacheco, who forces out McMullen at second. And that ends the inning as the Gators leave him loaded for the second time here tonight. But Florida adds two more and retake the lead. It's now 7-2. Gators on top as we head to the bottom of the fifth. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Gators in the top of the fifth inning, 2 runs on 4 hits, no errors, and 2 left on base. The score, after 4.5 innings of play, Florida 7, Jacksonville 5. Hercules tires are meant to dig dirt, sling mud, and pound pavement to get you safely to your destination. See what tires are right for you by visiting HerculesTires.com. Hercules Tires, the official tire of JU Athletics. Ride on our strength.
Jackson Grabski leads off the bottom of the fifth inning, 7-5. Florida leads it. And Jacksonville finds themselves in a position where they try to come from behind again. Grabski working, and he just got hit again. And I think he got hit right on the inside of the knee by Brandon Sproat. And Jackson Grabski's got to be saying, "What did I do?" And the trainer, Bo Owens, is going to come out to take a look. I don't know if it got him on the knee or the arm. It looks like maybe he got him right on the elbow, maybe the funny bone there on that left arm, and it has gone dead on him. So Grabski got hit back on the back in the first. He nearly got hit by a couple of pitches in the third before walking. He hasn't seen a ball in the zone since the very first one he saw tonight, which was a strike. So things seem to be okay for Grabski, which is good to see. He
for the Dolphins
had that issue with the shoulder back in the North Florida series where he dove to field a ground ball and ended up tweaking his shoulder, missed a game because of that. Takes that one on the elbow, and that's the third batter hit by a Gator pitcher tonight. He heads down to first to lead off the fifth, and now the tying run at the plate in the form of Duncan Hunter, who takes a first pitch fastball for a strike on the inner half. He has doubled in three runs and also walked here tonight. Hunter has now 14 RBI on the year. He is second on the team now in that stat, tied with Jesus Pacheco. The 0-1, and that gets away from Greenfield, rolling back to the wall, and Grabski able to move up 90. One ball, one strike to Duncan Hunter, who has an RBI opportunity again here. He has driven in runs in three consecutive games for Jacksonville, including this one. And the big right-handed bat with a chance to do some damage. 1-1 pitch, and he slices it foul over the seats to the right side. One ball, two strikes. Sproat got the final out of the fourth after giving up the 2-RBI double to Jesus Pacheco. Both of those runs charged to Ben Specht. The 1-2. Good eye by Hunter to take the slider away and lay off of it. He thought long and hard, but did not offer. 7-5 your score. Jacksonville having just given up a couple of runs, trying to get it right back. The 2-2, and Hunter checks his swing. Did he go around? The appeal to the first base umpire, Vic Correll, who's stationed at second base. He said no, he did not on a pitch down and in. Full count. Grabski still kind of rubbing that left arm a little bit where he took the pitch off of his elbow, takes his lead down at second base. Payoff pitch, and it's ball four and low. Duncan Hunter draws his second walk of the night. And the reason why Jacksonville has had success here on offense, despite just four hits, is because of the amount of free passes that have been issued by Gator hitters.
How about it?
Seven free passes by Gator pitchers, hit by pitches and walks combined. And that's it for Sproat. He gets one out, gives up a hit, hits one, walks one, and he heads to the dugout, and another right-hander trotting out from the right field bullpen for Florida. And David Lucci enters for Florida. He'll get loose. Jacksonville with two on and nobody out in the bottom of the fifth, trailing 7-5. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Gators, now pitching, number 17, David Lucci. Thank you.
Pitching change for the Gators. 7-5, Florida on top in the bottom of the fifth. They bring in their fourth arm of the night. It's David Lucci, who replaces Brandon Sproat, who goes a third of an inning in relief. And now Lucci, another right-hander, the sophomore from Vero Beach, Florida, enters the ball game, making his sixth appearance of the year. Lucci, 4 2/3 innings of work thus far. He has allowed opponents to hit .278 off of him, two strikeouts, three walks. His last appearance was April the 7th against FAMU. He went an inning and two-thirds. He really struggled that Friday night against Jacksonville down in Gainesville. Did not record an out. He allowed three hits, four runs, two earned, walked one, and throwing 17 pitches. That's good for an ERA of 99 on the night. Runners at first and second with nobody out, and Trace Burchard is 0-2 today. The Jacksonville catcher stands in. The right-hander kicks and fires. Burchard squares the bunt and gets it down off the mound to his right. Lucci rears back and fires on to first to retire Burchard, who successfully sacrifices the runners into scoring position. Jacksonville with a tying run now at second base. And Corey Heffron coming to the plate.
Now batting the left fielder, number 18, Corey Heffron.
A nice bunt there by Burchard, who collects his second sacrifice hit of his career. And now the ball gets passed on to Corey Heffron, who will try and drive them in. Heffron, with 12 RBI so far this season, is 0-2 on the night with a strikeout and a flyout. Runners at second and third, one gone. Bottom of the fifth inning, 7-5, Florida leads it. Lucci comes home, and a first pitch breaking ball misses up and in. Heffron had a chance to drive in Hunter back in the first inning. Struck out looking on a curveball, that tough pitch to swing at on an 0-2 count. Especially a catcher's eye there, and he flew out on the first pitch he saw in the fourth to center field. The 1-0. Another breaking ball up and in. Head coach Kevin O'Sullivan hoping to find one of these guys in the bullpen that can come in and consistently throw strikes. Really, both sides kind of dealing with similar issues here. Falling behind hitters, too many free passes. 2-0 pitch. Heffron takes a fastball high and away, and he's ahead 3-0. If he walks, the bases are loaded for Steven Moffitt, who is on deck. The inning started with Grabski being hit by a pitch. Then Hunter walked. The sacrifice bunt moved him into scoring position. We'll see what Heffron does here in a 3-0 count. The pitch. Fastball at the knees for a strike. From Lucci, and it's ball four low. A fastball missed. Heffron draws the walk, and Jacksonville has loaded the bases without a hit this inning. That has sort of been the name of the game. Pinch hitter coming in for Jacksonville, Tyler McKenna. Pinch hitting for Steven Moffitt, so Jacksonville goes to the bench to bring in a lefty to face off against the right-handed throwing Lucci. And Tyler McKenna, the last time he came up with the bases loaded, 2 weekends ago at FGCU, he parked one over the right field fence. A grand slam for his first career home run. We'll see what he has in store here tonight coming off the bench. Jacksonville is a team hitting .323, 10 for 31 with the bases loaded this year. Bases loaded, one out. First pitch from Lucci, and it's a fastball down low, and Lucci has gotten only one strike in there. That hasn't been swung at, I should say. Technically two strikes. The Burchard bunch counts as one, but the other one was just the get-me-over 3-0 fastball to Heffron. And he has really been all over the place since entering this ballgame. Bases loaded, one out. The 1-0 pitch to McKenna. And he takes a called strike on the inside corner, a fastball from Lucci to even the count at one. Kyle Richardson standing on deck. Grabski at third. Second base is Duncan Hunter. Corey Heffron at first. Great speed on the base pass for Jacksonville. Looking for a big pinch hit here for Tyler McKenna. 1-1 pitch. Runs inside. Another heater from Lucci. McKenna has taken three pitches since coming off the bench. We'll see if he gets anything that looks good enough to swing at. That one was close, but a good eye to let it go. Back ahead in the count. 2-1. And McKenna sends one foul to the left side. McKenna has been Jacksonville's most common pinch hitter this year. This is his sixth appearance off the bench. He's just 1-for-6 in a pinch hitting role yet this season, though. Trying to improve upon that here. Time called, and McKenna steps out for a moment. Does not use those batting gloves. Does go through BP with the batting gloves, but then does not use them during the game. Usually just keeps one on that low hand, that right lead hand on the bat. 2-2 pitch, and another foul ball spoiled out of play to the left side, and McKenna stays alive. McKenna 7-for-39 this year. All four of his RBI came on that grand slam at FGCU. And he knew it too. A little bat flip at the end as he headed up the base, first baseline. I mean, he crushed it. 2-2 pitch again. And McKenna takes a fastball away. The count has run full again. Three balls on three Jacksonville hitters here this inning. The previous two drew walks. We'll see what McKenna does with the bases loaded and one out, nowhere to put them. Trailing 7-5, trying to climb back into this one. Big pitch here for Lucci. Payoff pitch coming. And McKenna with another foul ball to the left side and out of play. Seven pitch at bat to Tyler McKenna coming off the bench facing David Lucci. Lucci has already thrown more pitches in this at-bat than he had thrown to the previous two batters he faced combined. Lucci has the sign come set with the bases loaded, delivers another payoff pitch, and the eighth pitch of the at-bat is put right next to the three of the previous ones off to the left side and foul. It has just been fastball central from Lucci. I'm not sure he's thrown a breaking ball in this at-bat. And he is just trying to blow one past Tyler McKenna, who's looking for a big RBI here, whether it comes via the walk or a hit. Another payoff pitch, and it is ball four high, and he gets it via the walk to bring Jacksonville within one. It's 7-6 on the bases loaded walk. And Jacksonville has scored a run this inning without a hit. And that is it for David Lucci, as Kevin O'Sullivan wasted no time in making the call to the bullpen as he made his way out to the mound. And another Gator pitcher, the fifth of the night, makes his way in from the bullpen out in right. We'll let you know who the new Gator arm is when we return. 7-6, Jacksonville within one, and have the bases loaded with one out in the bottom of the fifth. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Number 33, Trey Vanderwaal.
Gators go to the bullpen again. And the new pitcher in for Florida, Trey Vanderwee. He replaces David Lucci, who gets one out on a sacrifice bunt after Brandon Sproat was unable to record an out to start the inning. He is charged with that first run that scored, the Jackson Grabski run, after the bases loaded walk drawn by Tyler McKenna. It has gone hit by pitch, walk, sack bunt, walk, walk this inning to the Jacksonville lineup. Kyle Richardson coming to the plate for the Dolphins to face off against the left-hander Vanderwee.
First baseman, number 21, Kyle Richardson.
Vanderwee, the transfer from USC Upstate, the grad student from Longwood, Florida, making his second appearance against the Dolphins this year through an inning and two-thirds. Back on that Friday night game, gave up two runs, neither of them earned, on a hit and a strikeout. First pitch, Kyle Richardson fouls it off to the right side. And Jacksonville with the bases loaded and one out, trying to tie this game up, trailing 7-6. Richardson today hit by a pitch and scored a run an inning ago. The 0-1 pitch, he squares the bunt and gets it down, back to the mound, scooping to the plate, a force out there, Vanderwee. Glove flips home to where Greenfield had the right foot on home plate and just beat Hunter to it. Jacksonville trying to sneak one home there. And, you know, that one, if that bunt goes maybe a little further out, does that make things a little more likely, or maybe a little further down the line is what they were looking for there?
You're looking for something further down the line so the pitcher doesn't keep his bring his momentum coming home. But I think there was some miscommunication because Duncan Hunter didn't get a good jump down the third base line. Mm-hmm. So I don't know who missed what or where the communication bit, but it looked like Duncan didn't get the jump like he was expecting a bunt. And, well. And
Ruben Simayan, the record holder all time in hit by pitches, just wears another one. The first pitch he sees with the bases loaded, and Jacksonville has tied it up at 7, still without a hit here this inning. Have scored now two runs, and the bases staying loaded with two outs for Jesus Pacheco.
Seth DeWitt, if you're still watching or listening, I know you were. I mean, I don't know if he's upset about his record being taken from Ruben. I mean, Ruben had a lot more plate appearances in his career, you know, starting from the moment he got on campus. But talk about two very different players.
No doubt.
You know, power hitting right hander with, you know, Ruben just, you know, slapper all over the field, just wearing pitches. They come in all shapes and sizes, Scott.
Ruben gets his 10th RBI of the year there on that hit-by-pitch. And here is Jesus Pacheco, the eighth man to the plate this inning, and he swings through the first pitch from Vanderwee. 16th free pass of the ball game there, that hit-by-pitch between the two teams combined. That'll make a baseball game a little bit longer.
Could get interesting right here.
0-1 pitch, and Pacheco, a chopper to the left side, waiting on a field by Halter, throws across the diamond and throws out Pacheco by a couple of steps to leave him loaded and leave this game tied. Jacksonville scores two runs to tie it up without a hit, as Florida has a hard time in throwing strikes there that inning. Eight men come to the plate. We're tied at 7 as we head to the 6th. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Dolphins in the bottom of the fifth inning. Two runs on no hits, no errors, and three left on base. The score after 5 innings of play. Jacksonville 7, Florida 7. Want to support JU Baseball? Become a member of the Diamond Club. In addition to enhancing the student athlete experience, annual Diamond Club membership provides access to the best seats in Session Stadium, as well as opportunities to enjoy exclusive insights into JU baseball. For more information, visit judolphins.com. There is no better way to show your commitment to your Dolphins. Make a gift today.
So we're knotted up at 7 again. Jacksonville with another 2 spot to tie this thing up. They did it in the 4th and now again in the 5th, and we'll see if they can keep it tied here as Florida has had an answer. Well, both teams, you could argue, have had an answer all night long when it has come to situations like this. Another back-and-forth affair between these two, much like that Friday night game down in Gainesville. The Jacksonville ended up winning 10-9. 7-all as we head to the 6th, leading things off for the Gators. Josh Rivera, the shortstop. And the first pitch from Sam Brunig bounces in front of the plate and kicks back to the wall for ball one.
This is a textbook midweek affair right here. You got 7 runs on 12 hits. You got 7 runs on 4 hits. And you got a top 20 team tied with a 7-22 team. And, I mean, like we said before, the Dolphins are going to show up no matter what.
And that one nearly hits Rivera, a fastball that runs in.
And, you know, they've had a lot of bad luck, injuries, and just not the season they want. They have the talent. That has never been the question. They're a talented team. Just things haven't gone their way. But this is a midweek right here. This is what we're used to.
The 2-0 pitch upstairs. Jacksonville was on pace for about a 2-hour-and-15-minute midweeker last Tuesday. And I don't know if I jinxed it by thinking, because I didn't say anything to anybody. But I looked at the clock at one point with 2 outs in the 9th inning, Jacksonville up. And I go, maybe this could be the fastest game of all time. And then, well, it did not quite end the way that Jacksonville wanted it to, as ball 4 misses low and a leadoff walk issued to Rivera. And Jacksonville now taking their turn and putting free men on.
Sounds like it was your fault.
I wasn't even there, Chris, so I don't know. Can I really affect
the
game?
Why were you even worried about it? You didn't have the 4-hour drive home.
No, I didn't. But, yeah, I was sitting there ready to put a bow on a nice win. I had the graphic ready to go.
There aren't many things worse than an extra inning midweek game on the road.
That you lose.
That you lose. Like, if you pull it out, it feels better. But if you lose that, that's a long ride home.
Mm-hmm. Colby Halter showing bunt and takes a first pitch, and Brunig has missed high on 4 of his 5 pitches here this inning. Runner at first, nobody out in a 7-7 ball game in the 6th. That extra inning game last Tuesday for Jacksonville was the first since last season at Florida, when Jacksonville lost 3-2 in 10 innings to the Gators. Luckily, that was a much shorter drive home, but still painful nonetheless. Dolphins got guys on all the time in that game and just had a hard time driving them in. Brunig locates with a heater on the outside edge, and it's 1-1.
Only one I can think of is Florida State my junior year when J.C. Flowers hit the walk-off single to left.
Yep.
Yeah, it was an extra innings, though. It was a 9-inning game. But
a walk-off nonetheless.
Yeah,
still stings.
Yeah, that was the throw that the shoulder went out on, too. So it's a very long ride home.
Long and painful.
Yeah.
1-1 pitch. Fastball a little bit upstairs that time to Halter. 2-1. Jacksonville with a lefty throwing in the bullpen out in left field.
That was a young Mike Casale throwing on the mound at the time.
A still young Mike Casale, yes.
2017. He was a sophomore, too.
That's wild. Yeah, I think that was one of his first couple starts of his career. 2-1 pitch.
No, he was a relief. He was a closer. Because he
at that point in the season, as he misses, he miss away, or is that called a strike? Outside? All right. Again, Randy in his strike call. If you blink, you miss it.
Yeah, it was because he was on the mound in the bottom of the 9th.
That's what it was. Because that season, he ended up transitioning later on in the year to a starter.
Yes.
I think he may have started a Florida State one, or maybe my memory is fading on me. I've watched a lot of Jacksonville baseball
You've
the last few years.
I've watched a lot of Mike Casale.
I've watched a lot of Mike Casale, yeah.
7-8 years.
Think of the capital that Mike Casale is taking up in my brain.
Him and Dakota.
And Ruben. Throw over to first, and that one bounces off of the runner. Rivera rolls a little bit away. Rivera got up, was a little bit hesitant at first, and elects just to stay put.
How was Angelo up here?
He had fun.
He
had to go home to take care of his dog.
Yeah, he told me he was going to do the fifth, and he comes in the middle of the fifth. I'm enjoying a nice conversation with a couple friends trying to take an inning off, and this guy only gets three outs in. Unbelievable, Angelo.
Well, that was a long inning, to be fair.
Yeah, but
a long half inning.
You commit to an inning.
3-1 pitch, and that is strike two called. Halter had tossed the bat.
Colby Halter, a former player with him and Blake DeLamelaire over on the Dolphin side. Former Dodger scout team of my brother, Kevin Lehane, former Dolphin, coached them. And so I heard a lot of good things about Colby Halter and Blake DeLamelaire coming in. I think there's a couple more, but, I mean, I don't think I've ever heard a bad word about Colby Halter from anybody that's been around him in the Jacksonville area.
3-2 pitch, swung on and missed. The throw down to second as the runner took off, and a strike him out. Throw him out for the first two outs of the inning. Halter with kind of a half-hearted swing on that pitch up in the zone, and it worked out perfectly for Burchard to show off the arm from behind the dish as well as he throws out a man. And what a sequence of events that was, changing things from what Halter thought was ball four to strike two, and then a strike him out, throw him out for two outs. And a pitching change for Jacksonville, and the lefty brought in to face off against the lefty Corey Acton, who's had himself a great night, and that does it for Sam Brunig in relief here this evening. So he goes a full inning of relief, getting two outs there in the fifth, two here in the sixth, so an inning and a third. Bad math guy, you know, never been my strength. So the lefty makes his way in for Jacksonville, replacing Brunig, the fourth arm used tonight by the Dolphins. And it is Jack Carver who takes over for Jacksonville when we return. Tied at seven, bases empty, two gone. Corey Acton coming to the plate when we return in the top of the sixth. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Dolphins, now pitching, number 29, Jack Carver.
We gotta talk. I didn't even like him when I played here. Like, you know how miserable it was? Like, oh yeah, good, we're at a Whopper at 11, what do we have to eat? Sick Taco Bell for the first time this week. Or if Hayes, then they started feeding him.
Hayes sucks now.
So Jack Carver on in relief for Jacksonville, relieving Sam Brunig, who goes an inning and a third. Base is empty, two outs. Carver brought in to face the lefty Corey Acton, who has had a great night. He's walked, singled, driven in a run, and doubled as well. And Carver making
for the Gators.
His ninth appearance of the year out of the pen. One of the most oft-used guys, I believe would be the correct term there. And a freshman who has carved out a nice niche for himself, no pun intended there.
Nice.
Thanks. So here's Acton. Jacksonville trying to sit him down for the first time this evening. Carver's first pitch, that bounces off of the tip of the mitt of Burchard back to the wall. And it's ball one to Acton. The 1-0. And a called strike on the outside edge, evening the count at a ball and a strike. First outing for Carver since a difficult appearance at Florida State back on the 6th of April. He went just a third of an inning, walked a man, hit a man. Prior to that, he had his probably his toughest outing of the year against Stetson. Acton fouls one off to the left side, now 1-2, where he allowed 4 runs on 3 hits in an inning of work against the Hatters. Hit 3 batters on the 2nd of April, but that was after a stretch in which he was really good. In 4 straight outings, he had gone at least an inning, had allowed just 3 runs combined, scattered a bunch of hits. Breaking ball swung on and missed, and Carver sits down Acton. And that slider is so good when Carver has it dialed in. And when you get ahead of a hitter, it's amazing how good things happen. He strikes out Acton, and the Gators, thanks to a strike him out, throw him out, only bring 3 to the plate there in the 6th and are held scoreless. It's all tied up at 7 as we head to the bottom half. From Ben Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Jacksonville 7, Florida 7. JU Dolphins would like to thank the team behind the team, Baptist Health, proud to be the official healthcare provider of the Jacksonville Dolphins. Baptist Health, changing healthcare for good.
Seven, 7-7 ball game as we work into the bottom of the 6th. 3, 4, and 5 for Jacksonville due up here this inning. And Dakota Jalila starts it off. 1-for-3 here tonight with a single and a run scored back in the 1st. Alongside Chris Lehane, I'm Scott Manzi, back with you here at John Sessions Stadium. It is Trey Vanderwide who is back out to start the bottom of the 6th, and he locates a fastball down and away to Jalila, called a strike. And I mean, that's just something we almost have to make note of it. First pitch strikes, there have been so few of them, especially as this game has gone along. The 0-1 pitch. Ground ball hit down towards short. Rivera waits on it from the edge of the outfield. Grass throws and beats Jalila by a few steps for route number 1. And I'm sure, you know, the same way when it's happened for Jacksonville tonight, that Florida dugout and Kevin O'Sullivan, he's probably breathing a sigh of relief. It's like, I got the leadoff man out. You know, threw a strike and got a guy out.
Yeah, there hasn't been a lot of those on either side, and, you know, part of why it's 9:45 in the bottom of the 6th inning.
Yes, first pitch is a strike to Jackson Grabski, who's been on base 3 times today. He doesn't even have an official plate appearance yet, at bat, however. He has been hit twice and walked once. The 0-1. Fastball. Ooh, I don't know where that one missed, but it called ball 1.
Yeah, Grabski got probably the worst place to get hit as a hitter, right on the corner of the elbow.
1-1 pitch swung on and missed.
It's one of those ones where you see it a lot. It doesn't happen as much nowadays because everybody using the elbow guards.
Yeah.
That's one of those ones where it happens to you once. He might be wearing a elbow guard from here on out.
Breaking ball misses down in the dirt to even the count at 2.
It's a disgusting feeling because you can't feel your fingers.
Well, you're looking at something that you can't feel, right?
You're trying to squeeze your fingers. You can't. There's tingles all the way up, and there's times where your arm gets locked out.
2-2 pitch, grounded foul to the left side.
It was just an inner squad. And I got hit. I don't know who hit me, but I remember I'm at first base, and my arm was stuck sideways. I mean, it definitely didn't feel good, that's for sure, but it was the fact that I'm trying to run with, like, an arm cocked sideways.
Ground ball hit down toward third, charging in on a halter on the transfer, bobbles and drops it. And Grabski with a one-out single. Long way to go for Halter there charging in. Grabski runs fairly well down the line as well. Halter knew he had to rush it. And because of that, just not able to quite cleanly exchange that one. Would have been a nice play if he had made it. Jacksonville has a one-out base runner here in the sixth. Duncan Hunter, he's had a nice day at the plate as well. Drawn a couple of walks, three RBI double back in the first. Got everything started. First pitch swinging, ground ball just foul to the left of the line at third base. Halter had knocked it down behind the bag, but that was foul, but not by much. I like it when Duncan Hunter comes up and, you know, he identifies a pitch and he's aggressive early. He's a guy who, you know, at times in his career has taken a lot of pitches, and all of a sudden you find yourself behind an account, 0-1 pitch. And there's called strike two on a, well, it looked like a nice changeup away. Of course, here tonight, yeah, not a lot of pitchers have come out and fired a bunch of strikes here early, but that's besides the point. I think it's just a good chance for a guy to come out and identify, especially with a guy on, like, be aggressive. 0-2 pitch, way outside, and he lays off. Vanderwide has certainly looked better than the last couple of guys for Florida. You remember him when he pitched at Upstate? I know that was a long time ago now, but we had to go digging when we vaguely recognized the name. 1-2 pitch swung on and missed.
I remember at bats, but I don't remember
who you faced.
There's only a couple guys I actually remember facing, and that's because of the name I was failing.
Yeah,
I
yeah.
knew who I was. I remember
yeah, when you're facing Brady Singer in the regional, like you remember.
I remember every pitch. Yeah, that kid was good. Yeah. And him and, like, I remember Logan Gilbert. I remember my bats off Gilbert and the closer for Stetson.
Long hair, also started with a B.
Brooks Wilson.
Yeah,
I remember his at-bats just because that splitter was gross.
First pitch into Trace Burchard. Misses down and outside from Vanderwide. Lefty-on-righty matchup here with two outs and a runner at first. 7-7 ball game, bottom of the sixth. Jacksonville has not led since Florida took the lead from them in the top of the third. It tied it up twice. 1-0 pitch. Off-speed swung on and missed. The runner at first is Jackson Grabski with an infield single. Dolphins trying to advance him into scoring position here. Burchard looking for his first hit of the night. He's 0-2. Swing and a miss. Another nice-looking backdoor slider away from Burchard, and he'll take a moment to step out. Grabski takes his lead off first, the 1-2. And Burchard strikes out swinging. And Vanderwide with some words as he heads back to the dugout, fired up. A good inning of relief in which he struck out two and allowed just one infield single and held the Dolphins off the scoreboard. We stay tied at seven as we head to the seventh. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Ticket smarter. The smarter way to buy tickets to live events. For sports, concerts, and theater events, visit Ticketsmarter.com and download the app today.
Enke is sprinting in, guy racing down the line, has to make a call.
Give him a hit, it's a home game.
Okay. I think,
yeah, it's a home game, too.
Like, that's not an easy play. Depends, I know who's in play.
Grabski. Jack Carver out to start the seventh inning after he got the final out of the sixth via a strikeout. He faces the 9-1 and 2 inning hitters this inning as the Dolphins try to keep this one tied as we work through these late innings and maybe have a chance late to pick up a third win over a ranked opponent this year. So here's Cal Greenfield, who has singled, walked, and struck out tonight. And Carver sets his first pitch. And he tried to paint the outside corner. And Randy didn't like it. Ball one. Greenfield struck out when he tried to bunt his last time up. That 1-0 pitch misses high. He tried to bunt and fouled it. The first one off, pulled the bat back on the second one as he tried to move the runners up, and then half-heartedly swung through an upstairs fastball to end his at-bat. He's ahead in the count 2-0 here against Carver. The freshman sets and fires. And that is a slicer to the right side, but it's Richardson who has no trouble drifting to his left a couple of paces and then making the catch for out number one. At first, off that bat, I said, oh, man, we've seen that one a few too many times before. But that one not hit hard enough. Yeah,
too far down the barrel, or too far down the handle, and the Jacob Young had to pick up his thumbs before he stepped in the box.
Jacob Young singled his last time up, 1-for-4 tonight. First pitch, breaking ball, maybe a little bit up. That was a strike earlier in the ball game. Think about those Timmy Manning strikes called. And then the 1-0 misses as well. So again, Carver falls behind. Jacob Young. Bases empty, one out, 7-7 game in the seventh. Top of the order here for Florida trying to break through. They've got 12 hits here tonight as Carver locates a heater on the outside edge for a strike. Jack Carver, the youngster, working at a big spot here as he misses away on a slider that didn't slide. He is faced against a ranked team in Pitt in his first career outing. He has faced Florida once already this season back on March the 13th. 3-1 pitch. And that one just a little bit off as well. And Young trots down to first. He draws a one-out walk. Young was convinced on that one, though. We have seen Randy pull guys back into the box all night long. A little surprised that one didn't end up being strike two called. So here's Nathan Hickey, who doubled his last time up. Drove in a run. 0-for-3 prior to that at bat. There have been quite a few extra base hits. That was part of a three-double inning in the fifth for Florida. And they all went off the wall out in left field. Runner at first, one out. The lefty Carver takes a long look over there, comes home. First pitch to Hickey, buried in the dirt, blocked by Burchard. So if you're Jack Carver, who is the freshman pitcher who has gotten the most appearances out of the pen for Jacksonville this year, I mean, you pitched against now four ranked teams this year. Florida twice, Florida State once, Pitt once. Pitt wasn't ranked when they played him, but they were playing like a ranked team already at that point in the year. The 1-0 pitch, breaking ball that misses inside on Hickey. But for Carver, you know, you remind yourself, despite the success he's had at times this year, I mean, he was sensational at UCF in that midweek win back on the 30th of March. Three innings, one hit, five strikeouts. Earned the win for his efforts, his first collegiate win. 2-0 pitch is fouled straight back. But he's a freshman and a guy who as well, I mean, he's had to earn everything. And I know you appreciate a story like that, Chris Lehane. I mean, he came in. He wasn't quote-unquote heralded. He local product. And he worked his butt off in the fall, pitched well, and has pitched well enough here in the spring in his opportunities presented themselves to earn more high-leverage situations.
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome. And you love to see that. And that's what college baseball is. I mean, you always have those guys that outwork the people in front of them. As he pickoff move to first base, unsuccessful. But, yeah, you have those guys who, you know, just who want it. Who want it. And you know, just like me, I wanted it every single day and had my opportunity and held on to it. And that's what he's trying to do. So credit to him. And that's why you watch college baseball for, you know, stories like that. You're going to have the guys who are on the big scholarships, who are supposed to produce. They're going to be amazing to watch, but it's about this right here that makes college baseball fun.
A foul ball out of play to the left side.
You saw that. You know, you don't see it as much for the big schools, you know, the SEC, the ACCs. You don't see it as much there. You have some walk-ons mix in that have success, but, you know, the scholarship guys do their job. At those Power 5 schools, you see it at the mid majors and the smaller conference schools. And we watched it in Coastal Carolina when they won the national championship. You had a couple guys who were walk-ons to start their career. That ball's ripped down the right field line.
And that is rolling it down the right field line into the corner. Hickey taking a look at second base. He holds up on that throw in from Hunter that actually got past the cutoff man and rolls all the way into third base, where the lead runner holds at third, Jacob Young, but a one-out single for Nathan Hickey. And runners are at the corners, including the go-ahead run just 90 feet away for Florida as we work Kirby here in the Gators. Seventh.
Now batting the designated hitter, number 52, Kirby McMullen.
So Hickey with a couple of nice base hits. And now Kirby McMullen coming to the plate. He has one hit. That was back in the first inning. Has also reached via walk and a hit by pitch. Runners at the corners, one out. Jacksonville trying to roll one here. If there was ever a time for a double tree double play, now would be it. The first pitch to McMullen, and it runs well outside for ball one. And these are probably the toughest moments for a young guy, right? Like, you look at the jersey on the other side, and you know that's factoring in, especially for a kid who grew up around here. He knows Florida. Played against some of these guys Nathan Hickey, a guy that played at Providence, probably faced off against him maybe at some point. Breaking ball, tries to paint the outside corner, just stays up. 2-0. But you just got to, you know, settle down and just execute pitches.
You got to remember you're just playing baseball. It's the same game that you're playing when you were in fifth, sixth grade, just at a higher level.
2-0 pitch. Swing and a miss by McMullen.
It's hard. It's you know, I say it, and like it's the easiest thing to do just to play baseball. It is.
Yeah, if only it was so easy.
It's really hard, especially in these moments, these high-pressure moments against, like you said, these, you know, there's 30 some guys in that dugout who are wearing just a jersey that has a name on it that holds weight, but you know, if you put them in Dolphins jerseys like we're having an inner squad, it makes no difference, but the name holds weight.
Fastball runs away. Carver looking at his left hand a little bit there on that last one. Three balls and a strike to McMullen. A walk here loads the bases, and Florida's had them loaded up a handful of times already here this evening. They've actually left them loaded twice. Big reason why this game is tied despite the 8-hit disparity here tonight in favor of Florida. Carver locates at the knees, full count.
And that's no disrespect to the Gators. I mean, they're a top 20 team. They're a heck of a team. But, you know, the colors and the name, it does. It gets in, especially young players' heads, and it's hard to get past that.
Payoff pitch hit slowly down towards short, charging in Jalila. Field throws high onto first and gets the out on the stretch by Richardson. Well, that ball wasn't fielded necessarily cleanly by Jalila, who had to come in a long way. It rolled off the heel, kind of popped up in the air a little bit, but he stayed with it, barehanded that baseball, and fired a rocket onto first to get a big out there. But Florida able to take the lead again on the RBI ground out from McMullen. But yeah, it could have been worse.
Really nice play by Dakota there. I mean, it's a softly hit baseball. It's going to be a tight play at first base. He's got to sell out, full sprint to the ball, gets it with his glove. Like you said, it rolls up on him. It takes a tough hop on that lip there, rolls up on the heel of his glove. But Dakota, like we talked about in the beginning of the game, is a defensive wizard, bare hands it out of the air and just fires over to the first base for a great play.
First pitch to Judd Fabian, and he pops one out into right field. This one carrying back to the wall, but Hunter able to settle underneath of the track and makes the catch for out number three. So Florida retakes the lead on the RBI ground out by Kirby McMullen, but Jack Carver able to limit the damage. We head to the bottom of the seventh, time to stand and stretch here at John Sessions Stadium. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
One run on one hit, no errors, and one left on base. All right, fans, get on your feet. It's time for the seventh inning stretch. JU Baseball's seventh inning stretch is in honor of longtime JU supporter, Mr. John Sessions.
Pinch hitter for Jacksonville to lead off the bottom of the seventh, Elias Flowers pinch hitting for Corey Heffron as the 7, 8, and 9 spots in the order do up. We'll see if it looks like Tyler McKenna staying in at that designated hitter spot, at least as of now, though the lefty is on the mound in the form of Trey Vanderweed, who has gone an inning and two-thirds of relief. And his first pitch of the left-handed swinging Elias Flowers is inside for ball one. Flowers pinch hitting, dealing with a nagging leg injury that has really limited him. He got off to such a good start this year. 1-0 pitch is grounded foul to the right side.
Yeah, it's a huge loss for the Dolphins this year. I mean, obviously he's trying to get through it and get as much as he can, but this kid can play baseball. Mm-hmm. And I mean, he's just one of those guys that he's 100% all the time when he's on the field.
He is a competitor. 1-1 pitch, and he ropes one out into right field, but right at the right fielder Thompson, who squeezes it two steps into his right for out number one.
I mean, he can swing it. I mean, he can hit it. You saw a little bit last year in the early season, and then this year you've seen it. You've seen flashes of it. Obviously, he's been dealing with stuff, but he hits the ball so hard when he puts the ball in play. And I'm really excited to see the rest of his career as we move on. I think he's going to really have a nice career here.
Well, you know, hopefully he can get healthy and then get a chance to go play summer ball and then, you know, use that and parlay it into a good season next season. As a first pitch strike called to Tyler McKenna, who drove in a run on a bases-loaded walk, and what was a really nice at-bat, nine-pitch at-bat, before drawing that walk back in the fifth. The 0-1 pitch misses down and outside. It'll just be nice for a lot of these guys to have more of a normal offseason and use that to develop. 1-1 pitch, hit hard but foul to the right side. Especially some of these young guys that lost a valuable opportunity to develop last summer. Well, last season, the remainder of last season, and then last summer 1-2 pitch. McKenna swings and misses it off speed and strikes out. Vanderweed has undoubtedly been the best pitcher that the Gators have used in relief, and he may have been the Gators' best pitcher tonight in general. I mean, Timmy Manning can make an argument to that case, but you know, we 2 1/3 innings of relief now for Vanderweed, and he has allowed just 2 base runners.
There's a lot going on the scorebook tonight.
There's a lot going on. I know. I'm trying to decipher it. First pitch to Kyle Richardson is a strike. The 0-1 pitch misses low. Bounces away from Greenfield a little bit there, but nobody on base, so no harm. Base is empty. 2 outs. 1-1 count on Kyle Richardson, who is 0-2 tonight. Scored a run after he was hit by a pitch in the fourth and has played a nice first base as well here this evening. 1-1 pitch. Swung on and missed. Gators trying to stay in front, leading 8-7 right now as we work in the bottom of the seventh. Vanderweed, fourth strikeout of the night already here. 1-2 pitch. And it just misses low and inside to Richardson to even the count. Vanderweed, the fifth Gator arm of the evening. 2-2 pitch. Slapped on the ground down to short. Rivera stabs and fields it. Throws on to first. Beats Richardson by a step. And a 1-2-3 inning. Boy, we have not said that much here tonight. As Trey Vanderweed sits down the Dolphins in order as we head to the eighth. 8-7. Florida on top from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Score after 7 innings of play. Florida 8, Jacksonville 7. Be sure to check out JUDolphins.com and follow the Dolphins on social media on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube to stay in the loop and get exciting up-to-date news and content. That's JUDolphins.com and all Dolphins social media. For the Dolphins, now pitching, number 16, Jagger McCoy. Defensive substitution for the Dolphins. Staying in the game and playing left field, number 10, Elias Flowers.
New pitcher for Jacksonville to start the eighth inning. Jagger McCoy enters for the Dolphins. He replaces Jack Carver, who went an inning and a third of relief, allowed one run in that inning of work. Right now, that is the deciding run. The RBI ground out by Kirby McMullen after the walk and single. Got things going for the Gators in that seventh inning. And now McCoy making his first appearance in a week. Takes over to try and keep things close for Jacksonville. He gets to face 5, 6, and 7 here in the Gator order. Sterling Thompson due up first. We'll see if the lefty stays in or if head coach Kevin O'Sullivan goes to his bench or not. Looks like Thompson's still out there in the on-deck circle.
Thompson's had a good day at the plate. I'd expect him to, stay with the high hand. Don't overthink it. Don't play a matchup when you don't have to. I mean, you got a guy who's hit a ball out of the park today and has also hit one off with his fist out to left center field. I mean, when a guy's finding holes, is that the only 2 hits he has on the day? There's been a lot of hits.
For Thompson, yes. Yeah. There's only 2 hits. He's also walked.
Yeah, so, it's a guy that's he's found a way to get on base and he's put a ball over. I mean, don't overthink it. Let him play some baseball. A righty doesn't have to face a lefty every time.
Very true. First pitch in the left-on-left matchup is a fastball up and in. Ball one to Thompson. McCoy was the unfortunate man on the mound last Tuesday when Jacksonville lost in extras to the Citadel. Ground ball hit to the right side. It takes a bad hop on Richardson and off of his glove and into right field.
A stroke of bad luck there. I mean, Richardson got in a good position. It was a bouncing ball. He got to the backhand. He was ready for it and just hit a rock or hit his glove.
First pitch swinging and a foul ball down the third baseline. Nothing and one on Josh Rivera with a runner at first. And that one called a strike as McCoy took something off of it. Just locates on the inner half. Nothing and two to the Gators shortstop. And that pitch gets away from Burchard and rolls back to the wall. Now a runner in scoring position as Florida tries to add to their one-run advantage here. One and two on that wild pitch. And a runner in scoring position, but a strikeout swinging for Rivera and a big out number one for Jagger McCoy. Jacksonville needed that.
For the Gators. Now batting the third baseman.
Colby Halter stands in. Halter. Hey, he's been to the plate now five times here tonight. Gators working through the lineup for the fifth time. The sixth time will be coming up. Sometime in the ninth inning, if not earlier, McCoy trying to make sure it's not until the ninth. The first pitch he sees is belted out into left, right center field, charging in, laying out. Samayan makes the catch. What a play by Ruben out in center. He continues to make sensational plays. And I thought for sure that ball was landing for a base hit.
For the Gators.
And a great jump again for Ruben, and he has maybe patented good jumps out in center.
Told you. I mean, the guy, it's all about his first step. He's you know, it's a lot like, we were really fortunate to go from Parker Perez, who, you know, covered all fields.
First pitch misses high and outside, ball one to Corey Acton.
I mean, I used to say, 75% of the world's covered in water. The other 25% was covered by Parker Perez back in the day. Ruben, we didn't lose much when Ruben came in.
I mean,
his first step is unbelievable, and he can get the balls out in center field.
Also wears number four. The 1-0 pitch is sent the other way, going back on it. Flowers now twisting back to his right to make the catch for out number three. So no harm done by the error in the wild pitch, and Jacksonville still within a run. As we head to the bottom of the eighth, Dolphins try to tie it up, maybe even retake the lead. 8-7, Gators lead it. Jacksonville bringing the top of the order to the plate when we return from Van Wagner. This is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
7.5 innings of play. Florida 8, Jacksonville 7.
If a dude's throwing a no-hitter and that happens, that's an error. I mean, like, and it's not a question. Like, that's an error. You're not going to get that hit. It's
the opposite of a no-hitter.
If Hayes changes it, let me know, and I'll make a phone call. Just to pick an argument.
For all time.
You got to leave the house, but have a good time. Bring a good time on you.
for the Gators. Now pitching, number 16, Ryan Nabarkis.
A new pitcher for Florida here as we work to the bottom of the eighth inning. Ryan Kabarkis takes over for Trey Vanderweide, who was very good in relief. 2 2/3 of relief work. And he is in line for the win if this one holds the way it is. Jacksonville trying to change that, however, and they're probably happy to see a different arm. Ryan Kabarkis making his eighth appearance of the year. The left-hander, 5 2/3 innings pitched. 4 strikeouts, 3 walks. Opponents hitting 304 off of him. So he continues to get loose. Kabarkis, a freshman from American Heritage, redshirt freshman. He did not face Jacksonville earlier this year. He has pitched last against Tennessee on the road on the 11th of April and went just a third of an inning, gave up 2 hits, 2 runs, walked one, and gave up a homer. It's the top of the order for Jacksonville. And Ruben Simayan, who just made that tremendous play out in center field to rob Colby Halter of a base hit in the top half of the inning. Up, he has been on base 3 times today, has singled, walked, and been hit by a pitch. He drove in a run on that hit by pitch. Back in the fifth to tie the game up. First pitch from Kabarkis, and it's a fastball high for ball one. And a 1-0 fastball misses low and outside. 2-0 to Samayan. Jacksonville trying to get that tying run on base here in the eighth. The 2-0 pitch, and Samayan watches that one into the bottom of the zone, called a strike. Ruben started things off in this ball game for Jacksonville with a single. He came in to score when Duncan Hunter cleared the bases on a double down to the left field corner. 2-1 pitch. Swing and a miss on a fastball past him to even the count. That was the gave Jacksonville an early lead, that 3-run first inning. Florida took the lead for the first time in the third, and ever since have either led or it has been tied. Ground ball hit down towards short. Rivera charging in, vacuums it up off the dirt, and throws on to first on the run for out number one. Rivera is just so slick. I mean, we have been treated to some excellent shortstop play here tonight from Jalila on Jacksonville's side and Rivera on Florida's side. I mean, just two guys that can really make things look easy out there. Pacheco with the bases empty and one out. Jacksonville trailing 8-7. First pitch, breaking ball, called a strike on the inner half. A 1 pitch, and Pacheco lays down a surprise bunt down the third baseline, but it rolls foul about a quarter of the way up the line. It caught the lip where it transitions from dirt to grass there. It was fair at that point, but that, combined with the spin, just kind of popped it up in the air and rolled it foul. Good idea there from Pacheco. I mean, that ball, you know, stays down the line, and he's got himself an easy bunt single.
Yeah, it's a good idea by Pacheco. I mean, like you said, it's one of those ones where it's got to be perfect or foul. And, you know, he did his job. He put it as close to the line as he could. Obviously, it took a bad hop and rolled away, but it's a really good idea.
0-2 pitch, and he spoils one back into the netting. Pacheco with that huge 2-RBI double back in the fourth. His lone hit of the night, 1-for-4 on the evening. That double, the fourth of his young Jacksonville career. Two of them coming against the Gators. Oh, another 0-2, and he lifts a breaking ball down the right field line foul. And that gets beyond the netting where that foul territory kind of curves in. Also looking forward to that becoming a kind of a party area down there in right field again next year when things are more normal. Right now it's a front row seat for Les Wright as he sits there in the Gator, the 0-2. Swing and miss on a tailing fastball away, and that is out number two here in the eighth. So it's up to Dakota Jalila here to extend this eighth inning. Kabarkas trying to sit down the Dolphins in order again here in the seventh to match what Vanderweide did in the seventh. It was Jacksonville has had just one base runner over the last three innings, and that was that infield single for Jackson Grabski. Other than that, it has been really efficient for these Gator pitchers after that really tough part in the middle of the ball game. First pitch breaking ball goes off the glove of Greenfield back to the wall. Ball one.
Yeah, Dolphins only have four outs to work with. I mean, it just seems like one run is a mountain to climb right now. Hopefully this the top of the lineup here can get things going.
1-0 pitch fouled back. And probably feels a little bit that way because, I mean, Jacksonville's done his damage, but not with hits, right? Like,
yeah,
I mean, it's been
gotten
a lot of free passes,
yeah,
and now they've taken advantage.
Help.
But
they've gotten a lot of help from the Gator pitching staff, but you know, at some point you hope for that big hit to come, and as Coda takes ball two,
yeah,
you hope that top of the lineup can get something going, and really it's all about the big hit. Who can get the big hit? Who can get the two out RBI? And you know, they only got four outs to work with here, so
2-1 pitch. Fastball belted back up to the center field. Going back on it. Fabian goes all the way back in front of the warning track and tracks it down for out number three. Kabarkas out of the pen faces the minimum in the eighth, and we head to the ninth. 8-7, Florida on top. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
Score after eight innings of play. Florida 8, Jacksonville 7.
Of the water, we were feeling all right. Back down a country road, the girls are always hot and the beer is ice cold. Cadillac, horns on the hood. My buddy Frankie had his dad hook him up good. Girls smile when we roll by, they hop in the back and we cruise to the riverside.
It's Jagger McCoy back out for the ninth inning. 8-7, your score. Florida leading Jacksonville in what has been a back-and-forth affair here on this Tuesday night. Final matchup between these two teams this season and the regular season. And the 98th all-time between Jacksonville and Florida. Dolphins trying to take two against Florida this season in the four matchups. Here in 2021, they'll have to come from behind in the bottom of the ninth, and McCoy trying to keep it tight. Leading things off, Cal Greenfield, 9-1-2 for the Gators here in the ninth inning. Greenfield 1-for-3. He shows bunt to start things off, pulls the bat back and takes a strike. That's the second time tonight we've seen that with Greenfield, who is elected not to actually offer at a bunt that ends up being a called strike. The 0-1, and he takes away off speed this time, a ball and a strike. McCoy in his second inning of relief work, the fifth pitcher used by Jacksonville tonight. The 1-1, swing and a miss, and McCoy really has a good way to buckle some knees. I mean, he doesn't throw hard, throws a lot of pitches with movement.
Classic soft lefty. He's got the changeup to go after the right-handed hitters, and my least favorite pitch, the left-handed changeup.
1-2 goes to the breaking ball. Thought he had strike three called. Doesn't get it, and it's 2-2 to Greenfield. Two-two pitch, and Greenfield down to a knee, just gets a piece of it. No, it got away from Burchard. Never mind, a swing and a miss, and a throw down to first after he collects it. I thought for sure that Greenfield had fouled that one off because I heard like a double click, but it just went right off the mitt of Burchard, and he's able to save himself a little bit there and ensure that that first out counts.
I thought it was a foul ball too. I'm not sure if he would have stayed in the box if Randy Olhausen would have knew to. I guess we're not out there. We can't hear it, but it looked like he fouled it off. But
right. I heard kind of that double click, but it is what it is, and it's out number one, and Jacksonville will take it. Jacob Young, top of the order, back up, and a big swing and a miss to start the at-bat. And Young has been on his last two times. Young's walk in the seventh. Very important. Go-ahead run. One out. He tries to add insurance now if he can get on base and help this Gator lineup that is combined for 13 hits tonight. Build a little breathing room as he takes a ball upstairs. It's now 1-1. Hickey on deck for Florida. He has been very good in his last two at-bats as well, doubling in a run and singling. The 1-1. And that is just a little away, too, and Jagger McCoy trying to paint the outside corner to these righties and having a hard time with it. McCoy from the first base side of the rubber kicks and fires. 2-1 pitch, and he goes to the changeup again and a half-hearted swing and miss by Young. That's got to be an empty feeling when you start a swing and you realize there's absolutely no chance that I am going to touch this baseball. And you watch it come in slow motion as you're just falling down, swinging over it.
It never happened to me, Scott.
Yeah, you're right. I forgot you were
never
1,000.
Never swung and missed.
You batted 1,000. So good. 2-2. Foul ball straight back.
No, I didn't bat 1,000. I just never swung and missed.
Oh, that's what it was. Yes. Sorry. Yeah, you struck out only looking and flying out and grounding out. And however other ways, I know there's a full list popping up into foul territory, and I'm not going to run through them. It's too late at night for that. 10:30 now here in Jacksonville. Ground ball hit down to short. A couple of hops fielded by Jalila on to first. And while Young runs really well, Jalila's arm is better, and he beats him for out number two.
For the Gators now batting.
Young is a guy, he almost has a little of that Ronald Acuna to him, right? A ground ball down to short, and you have to hold your breath a little bit.
Okay, we're talking about the base. Okay, if we're talking about running out.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. I elaborated.
Okay.
I elaborated.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just talking about that kind of speed.
You worried me there for
that
a second.
That kind of speed. Maybe Trey Turner speed. That'd be another comparison.
Trey Turner can burn.
The Acuna one's just top of the mind as the first pitch fastball misses up.
Yeah, that
into
what
Hickey.
He did. What he did against the Phillies.
Not to dig up.
Lead off the inning
bad
or lead off
there.
The game. Nah, it's all right.
It's April.
Yeah, they just blew a game against the Giants. It's all right.
That was sensational, though.
Oh, yeah.
Hard hit ball, line drive right at the second baseman, Pacheco. And that is out number three. And it's the first 1-2-3 inning for a Jacksonville pitcher tonight. We head to the ninth. Jacksonville down one, looking for a little late inning magic here against the ranked Florida Gators at home. 8-7 your score. And the Dolphins bringing Grabski, Hunter, and Burchard to the plate when we return. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network. We'll be right back. Here we go. It all comes down to this. The bottom of the ninth of a one-run game. Jacksonville trailing Florida 8-7. And 4, 5, and 6 coming up for the Dolphins. Jackson Grabski leading it off, looking for his to stay perfect in plate appearances today. Has yet to be retired. He's been hit by a pitch twice, walked and singled. And the biggest thing in these innings, you want to see that leadoff guy get on. Ryan Kabarkis out for another inning of relief work. First pitch from the lefty, and he bends in a breaking ball. 4-1 in the inner half to the right-handed swinging Jackson Grabski, and that is how we start the bottom of the ninth. Kabarkis already has one save this year, looking for his second, the 0-1. Breaking ball hammered down the left field line, but that is floating toward the pavilion. That wasn't hit as hard as it looked initially off the bat. I got fooled a little bit even by that one, as he got it a little thinner than it initially looked, and that ball just sort of drifted into the pavilion, which is cleared out as this game has gotten later on a Tuesday night. 0-2. It has been a couple of breaking balls here early to Grabski. What does Kabarkis go with here? Fastball tries to paint the outside corner and just misses away.
Yeah, he got it off the end of the bat. Didn't really. It got a little out in front, didn't like really carry as much as you played it off to be.
Well, I got excited there for a moment. I was a Cubs fan who got to be the number one fan base for overreacting to fly balls into the outfield, right?
I don't know. I've never been to Wrigley. Always wanted to.
Every pop-up sounds like a home run. 1-2 pitch, and Grabski with a great job to stay alive, reaching down on a pitch near his shoe tops.
It's like going to a minor league game.
Yeah, a little bit of that feel, yeah.
You go to a shrimp game on Thursday nights, and you just got a bunch of people who are casually they watch.
They hear the crack of the bat and they look up.
Yeah, they look up, they see a ball, they get excited. That's minor league baseball.
Another 1-2 and a ball down and in. Halter guarding the line down at third. He walks over near the bag to do a little dirt manicuring. And he goes right back to his spot. A pace or two off the line at third base. Rivera playing shaded over to the hole. A big spot up the middle for Jackson Grabski here if he can send one back where it came from. 2-2 pitch from Kabarkis. Breaking ball and another foul ball, and that got a piece of home plate umpire Randy Olhausen.
Yeah, they're playing no doubles down the third baseline. Surprised to see how much room they have down the right field line. Obviously not a likely scenario, you know, especially in the world of analytics and knowing where these guys are going to hit the baseball. But, you know, you don't want to put the tying run at second, maybe even third base.
Another 2-2 and another foul ball, and Olhausen just got hit again. Boy, oh boy, Jackson Grabski, who has been hit by a couple of pitches tonight, now taking out some of his frustration on Olhausen. And Greenfield buys Olhausen a little bit of time by going out to hand deliver a baseball, and he's going to take a little extra time out there as well. Randy's sitting there going, it's been 3.5 hours, long night behind the plate, and in the bottom of the ninth, this is what's happening to me? 8th pitch of the at-bat to Grabski, who's fouled off a handful here already. Another pitch from Kabarkis, and a breaking ball high and outside, and it's a full count. Well, this is the at-bat you're looking for to start things off. And this is a young guy who is professional in his approach. Grabski is not an easy guy to retire as a true freshman. Big pitch here. Payoff pitch. Kabarkis comes home, and Grabski strikes out swinging on an upstairs fastball, and he is frustrated with himself, to say the least. Well, Kabarkis just put everything he had behind that one and let it rip. And Grabski might not be able to use that bat again by the time he's done with it.
Yeah, you can tell he wanted that one really bad and worked a great at-bat, fought a couple pitches, worked it to a 3-2 count, and just a really good pitch there. Fastball top of the zone, maybe even touch above it, and got Grabski to go after it.
First pitch, breaking ball floats away from Duncan Hunter. An easy pitch to take for ball one. And Kabarkis says, you know what, I think I need a new baseball.
Pitchers, man.
You think the the ball with the dirt or the scuff or whatever. It'd be easier to throw a breaking ball with. But nonetheless, fresh one for Kabarkas, who comes home with a 1-0 and blows a fastball past Hunter. And that even looked funny when he released it a little bit there, too. It's almost like he let it go a little late. But, man, did he power it past Hunter. One ball, one strike, one out, bases empty. Jacksonville trailing 8-7 in the bottom of the ninth. Top 20 Gators here in town. 1-1 pitch runs inside on Hunter with another heater. He's ahead in the count now. And Hunter, who struck out his last time up, has put together some nice at-bats here tonight. 2-1 pitch inside again.
Another really good at-bat by a Dolphin hitter. I mean, they're not giving in. And, I mean, hopefully you get that pitch that you're looking for and you don't miss it. And, you know, 3-1 count, Duncan might have an opportunity here to put a charge into one.
3-1 pitch. And he does take a big swing but fouls it straight back. Got the fastball he was looking for, just couldn't quite keep it straight.
Yeah, it's a really good swing there. That's what you want to see. You don't want to see a batter giving up his at-bat in a 3-1 count just trying to put a ball in play. I mean, you're either going to hit the ball a long way or hit it in a gap, or you're going to swing and miss or foul it. And, you know, that's what Duncan did there. He took a really good swing, but now he's got to fight with another 3-2 count here, another high-pressure pitch.
And another payoff pitch from Kabarkas to a Dolphin hitter, and Hunter with a fly ball headed out to right field. This is drifting in between two men, and it's Acton at second base who calls off the right fielder Thompson and makes the catch. Well, that was tracking into dangerous territory there in shallow right, and the Gators do a nice job to get the second out of the inning.
Yeah, he went back with the same pitch he got Grabski on. He got the fastball up in the zone, elevated it. You know, it's tough to get the hands there, especially when you're in a defensive mode. You're trying, you got to make sure you cover the whole plate. You got to make sure you cover every pitch. It's funny. It's almost easier to hit in a 2-2 count and fight off pitches than it is in a 3-2 count. And credit to the Gator pitcher putting it up in the zone.
Burchard takes a fastball high to start the at-bat. He is hitless here tonight. He needs to change that, or at least get on base in order to extend this, as Jacksonville's down to its final out, trailing 8-7 in the bottom of the ninth. The 1-0 from Kabarkas, breaking ball upstairs. And now Coach O'Sullivan makes his way out of the Gator dugout. It's been a while since we've seen him. It felt like he was out there every 5 seconds there for a while there in the middle of this game. But now he has seen his pitcher get a couple of outs, but has had to really work for him.
Yeah, I mean, Kabarkas, he got the first two outs, strikeout, but he hasn't necessarily been filling the zone up. He got three ball counts. Both of the strikeout pitches were, I would say, probably balls above the zone.
Yep.
Duncan's may have been the top of the zone. I think Grabski's was a ball, and then he misses the first two pitches there up in the zone. So, you know, he's gotten away with it, and you know, he at least is attacking the hitter. He's not missing by a lot, but I think O'Sullivan wanted to go out there and calm him down a little bit. He's missing up in the zone. He's probably a little worked up. So, I mean, 2-0 count here. It's another great opportunity here for Burchard to get a runner on.
And after the mound visit, Kabarkas misses again. 3 balls, no strikes to Burchard. He could be the tying run if he can get on base here. Elias Flowers standing on deck. 3-0 pitch with 2 outs. And it is a fastball at the top of the zone. Halter keeps creeping a little bit closer to that line down at third. Now drifts off. Now right back. He's maybe 2 feet off. Rivera in shallow left field at shortstop. Another big hole kind of up the middle here for Burchard. 3-1 pitch. And it's ball four way high. And the tying run is on base for Jacksonville with 2 outs in the bottom of the ninth inning.
Hardest out to get in baseball, the 27th. I mean, you never know what's going to happen here. And we talked about it earlier. A lot of damage has been done by both teams with 2 outs. And, you know, we saw it earlier in the game with the Gators. And, you know, the third out's the hardest to get of the inning, especially when, you know, it's a one-run game and you need one more out to finish it. It's every pitch is a high-pressure pitch, and And you have a guy up right now that, I mean, it's a lefty matchup, but a guy who can really swing the bat and a guy, you know, guy who can run on first base. If he gets a ball in the gap or down the line here, we might have a tie ball game.
Flowers with a nice piece of hitting in his last at-bat, but he flew out to right field, a breaking ball down in the dirt to start the at-bat. 1-0 to Flowers in his second plate appearance of the night after coming in as a pinch hitter back in the seventh. And that is it for Ryan Kabarkas. A pitching change with two outs, a runner on first, and a 1-0 count in the bottom of the ninth. And so Jacksonville and Elias Flowers set to face off against a new arm here in the what may be the waning moments of this game. So no save for Kabarkas. He was that close to picking up his second of the year. But instead, a right-hander makes his way in out of the pen. Interesting here to bring in the righty to face off against the left-hander, Elias Flowers, with another lefty on deck in Tyler McKenna. So we will see how things go. We'll step aside and let you know who the new pitcher is when we return. From Van Wagner, this is the Jacksonville Dolphins Sports Network.
For the Gators, now pitching, number 29, Jordan Carrion.
Jordan Carrion enters the ball game, replacing Ryan Kabarkas. An inning and two-thirds of relief for Kabarkas. And he was unable to get that elusive final out of the ball game, so he leaves with two outs and a 1-0 count here in the ninth with the tying run at first base in the form of Trace Burchard, who walked moments ago, and now Elias Flowers set to face off against a right-hander after starting things off against the lefty. And Carrion, he has been good. Has not allowed a run this year in 6 1/3 innings pitched. 8 strikeouts, 2 walks. Opponents hitting just a .182 off of him. And I think Kevin O'Sullivan just said, we just need to end this thing. And he brings in a guy who is perfectly capable of doing that in Jordan Carrion. And we'll see if Elias Flowers can continue to battle. First pitch, grounded down to the right side, charging in onto Acton, comes up, tosses on to first, beats Flowers by a step, and that's your ball game. So Carrion gets his first save on just one pitch. And Florida hangs on to win 8-7 over Jacksonville here tonight. Chris Lehane, this was a back-and-forth type of affair. Jacksonville battles close, but at the end of the day, just couldn't come over that clutch hit late in the game when they needed it.
Yeah, and the Dolphins really got helped out by the Gator pitching staff and you know, some walks and hit by pitches and you know, timely mistakes. But yeah, just couldn't get the hit you're looking for to put them over the edge. I mean, Dolphins had a lot of opportunities, but that two-out hit, you know, when it doesn't come, it's hard to win a ball game at the end of the game when you haven't done it all game. So, and they've struggled to do it all season. So, you know, hopefully they can answer back here with Gulf Coast this weekend and get back on track with the
North Florida this weekend.
Oh, it's UNF. Yep. I'm looking at the scoreboard. Oh, their next home game. But yeah, so hopefully they can get back on track against North Florida and get a couple wins in conference.
All right, your winning pitcher tonight, Trey Vanderway. He gets his first win of the season. First win as a Gator. He's now 1-1 on the year. Jack Carver takes the loss. He falls to 1-2 for Jacksonville. And how about a save for Jordan Carrion, the first of his season as well. With the win, Florida improves to 26-11 on the season. Jacksonville falls to 7-23. For Chris Lehane and Angelo Amendolari, I'm Scott Manzi saying so long. Your final score, Florida 8, Jacksonville 7. Dolphins prevail here at John Sessions Stadium tonight. From Van Wagner, this has been a presentation of Jacksonville University Athletics. 1-2.